fast asleep while your people knock on doors. To get a loan or get a job, take one scrubbing floor. The 1% has more of your wealth than the 90% combined. Millions live in poverty. Now it's time we realize we gotta wake up now. We gotta look and see things aren't the way that they ought to be. America, your children cry from the hunger they endure, and millions more will suffer as their families grow more poor. The schools that have the rich man's child print diplomas framed in gold, while poor kids fail in their hopelessness and their future is dark and cold. We gotta wake up now. We gotta look and see things aren't the way that they ought to be. We want to ride the bus you ride. We want to use the doors you use. We want to hear the sounds you hear and choose the path you choose. Now technology can draw us close if it is there for all. But if you can't read or pay the bills, then you can't make the call. We gotta wake up now. We gotta look and see things aren't the way that they ought to be. Now working is a human right. It builds community. But millions are excluded by a few with selfish greed. We have the skills, the hearts, and the minds. We're equal to the task. But we've been robbed of our right to work, and they didn't even need a mask. We gotta wake up now. We gotta look and see things aren't the way that they ought to be. Now our hospitals rise to the sky. They're the best, so we are told. But not if you are uninsured, then you're kept out in the cold. As Washington cuts the safety net and millions fall away, those children may be out of sight, but there'll be a debt to pay. We gotta wake up now, sing along. We gotta look and see things aren't the way things are.
Cleveland, Ohio. I'm Tavis Smiley, and you are, sir?
Cornel West in Cleveland. Blessed to be here. You
know. Let's hear it for Jeff Morey and the band.
Jeff Morey is sounding good. Sounding good.
For those listening and watching around the country as we engage this poverty tour in these town halls in four battleground states, of course, today in Ohio, then on to Virginia and Pennsylvania and Florida, for the live audience who has gathered with us today, and for that matter, on every stop of the tour, we're blessed to have our own house band. I've been doing TV and radio for 20 years. I have never had a house band. So we are delighted on each stop on our tour, and we have different kinds of music too. I know when we get to Philadelphia, we're doing the town hall in Pennsylvania, doing the town hall from a black church. Our friend, Pastor Moore.
Oh, indeed.
At the 10th Moore Baptist 10th Church Moore, yeah. in Philadelphia. So we have gospel music in the church for obvious reasons. So we're going to be blessed to hear music throughout this tour. We're going to talk to Jeff Moore here in just a second, though. But before we do that, let me just say how delighted we are that so many of you here in Cleveland have come out to be with us for this conversation today. The very first stop on the Poverty Tour 2.0. And that's nothing to really celebrate. It's kind of weird to say thank you for coming to a conversation about poverty in America, because I'd much rather be here under different circumstances. But Dr. West and I figured that since Obama and Romney have taken up residency in Ohio, so should we. So we decided to come to Ohio as the first stop on what is going to be, again, a four-state tour. Just some quick background for those who, you know, might not know what Doc and I have been doing on this issue. We've been talking about this issue for 20 years of my media career. I've been talking about it. Dr. West, of course, been at it a little bit longer than me, teaching and being an advocate, and in his case, going to jail countless times for these kinds of social justice issues. But over the last few years, as we all know, poverty has gotten so worse, so much worse in this country. Literally, as we speak right now, I mean, at this very moment in Washington, the federal government is releasing its official poverty numbers. And we're going to talk more about that, of course, over the next few hours. But later in this program, in fact, we're going to bring you some highlights of the live press conference that's going on right now in the nation's capital, where the official poverty numbers are being released. What we suspect we're going to hear today is that we are now experiencing the worst poverty in this country in decades, the worst poverty in 50 years. And when you combine, Doc, the job numbers from last Friday, the dismal job numbers from last Friday, with today's abysmal poverty numbers, what I think we're going to see is that poverty has become the new American norm. It ought to be abnormal. That is to say, poverty ought to be abnormal, but it's the new normal. But what's your sense of what to expect today from these poverty numbers?
Well, it looks bad, but it was already bad. It's already bad. And we're just simply here to bear witness to justice and say it's a moral obscenity that so many of our precious brothers and sisters of all colors live in poverty in the richest nation in the history of the world. And that's a legacy of Martin Luther King Jr., of Dorothy Day, of Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel, and others. And we just want to make sure that poor people are in or at the center of any public conversation in this nation during an election, during a campaign, or any other moment.
So we are starting today again in Cleveland, Ohio. For those listening again and watching across the country, want to follow us, you can go at any time to our website at smileyandwest.com, smileyandwest.com, to get all the details about the tour. But we will be tomorrow, that is Thursday, in Alexandria, Virginia. Let me just back up and give you the whole rundown. So we're at the Idea Center. We'll talk more about that in a second. We're at the Idea Center here now in Cleveland today. For those in Cleveland, this evening from 5 to 7, we will be at Triple C, Cuyahoga Community College. I always love saying that, Cuyahoga. Cuyahoga Community College tonight from 5 to 7 here in Cleveland. Then tomorrow, on Thursday the 13th, from 10 to 1, we will be in Alexandria, Virginia at the T.C. Williams High School. For those who saw the movie Remember the Titans, that high school that was featured in that film is an actual high school called T.C. Williams. So we're going to T.C. Williams High School in Alexandria, Virginia tomorrow. Virginia, of course, a battleground
state.
That
means we'd be on the bus all night tonight.
We're going to be on the yes, that's what it means. I didn't want to tell you that. But it means we're going to be driving all night from Ohio to Virginia.
I got my Curtis Mayfield and Luther, so I got some.
You got some CDs with you?
Yeah, I got some CDs.
Okay,
yeah,
good. Actually. So we're going to be driving all night. We got some Jeff Moyer CDs, too, maybe. So we
Brother Jeff helped us out, Moyer. Too.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. So we're going to be driving all night to Virginia tomorrow, Alexandria, Virginia, 10 to 1 at T.C. Williams High School. Then on Friday at the, I'm sorry, tomorrow night, Thursday night, we'll be at Delaware State. Mm. We'll be in Dover, Delaware for just a lecture and book signing tomorrow night, the 13th. At 8 o'clock at Delaware State. Then on Friday, we'll be in Philadelphia at the 10th Memorial Baptist Church from 10 to 1. That's Friday. And then on Saturday, we'll be down in West Palm Beach, Florida. So we got a wonderful tour lined up for this entire week. Before we talk to Jeff right quick, let me thank Doc, 90.3 WCPN and WVIZ PBS and Ideastream. Please thank them for hosting and having us here.
Absolutely.
I've been blessed to be on public TV and public radio for 12, 14 years now, I think. And WCPN has always been such a strong supporter of my work and now my work with Dr. West. So thank you, WCPN, for having us. Thanks to Dave Kanzig, Ella Fong, Jeff Carlton, and the entire staff for making arrangements for us to be here. Our community partners, we want to thank them as well here in Cleveland, the City Club of Cleveland and Kent State University, the Ohio Employee Ownership Center. Please thank our community partners as well for having us here. And last, I want to thank Jeff Moyer, Kevin Richards, Joe Hunter, Ed, and Brother Harris on the drums, the house band. Please thank them again one more time for being with us today. We have a whole lot of folk we're going to talk to in this hour. We are being seen around the country and heard around the country. Huffington Post is our official media partner. So this tour is being covered live every day, all day on the Huffington Post and The Root and so many other outlets in social media are covering this. So we've gone viral, Dr. West. You have gone viral, brother. I just want you to know that.
Who would have thought? Thought?
Here's a guy who just got a cell phone a couple days ago. So, and still doesn't have a computer, but now he's
no
viral.
No computer yet. I'm working on that.
Now he's viral. We're going to talk to a lot of folk in this hour. So we got a lot of good stuff, a lot of organizers, some folk wrestling with poverty over the next couple hours. Some elected officials are going to join us. We're going to really get the conversation going here in Cleveland about how we're going to make poverty a priority in this country. But for now, Jeff, I want to say thank you for bringing the band out and for sharing such wonderful music with us over these next 3 hours. Tell me about the band right quick and how you got all these guys together.
Well, this was a wonderful opportunity to get together with some old friends. This is hardly my band. These are four outstanding independent musicians. Kevin Richards on mandolin, electric guitar, who's the head of Roots of American Music, a program that brings through traditional music, education, advocacy, and bringing community together in education and schools, raising a level for everyone through teaching and bringing people together through music. Mm-hmm. Joe Hunter, who is on the faculty of the famed jazz studies program at Tri-C, Cuyahoga Community College, and the busiest jazz pianist in Cleveland. Ed Lemmers, who is head of his own band, Eclectic Vision, and also the bassist for the Travis Haddock's band, and a remarkable bassist. And Hari Sevastopoulos, who worked many years ago in Greece, working against the junta through music and advocacy, and is a drummer here in Cleveland and in many settings. So it's just a chance for all of us to get together and support you. And I want to say that I think that the two of you should be required listening for all members of government and all branches of government.
We agree.
That's very kind, my brother. That's very kind. Because we think it's so important that we begin with the music, because for Brother Tavis and myself, music is not decorative or ornamental. Yes. It is integral and constitutive of who we are. And when you really want to keep track of the rich humanity of poor people, here and around the world, blues, rebetiko in Greece, it could be bluegrass, it could be jazz, it could be hip hop, it could be rhythm and blues. I'm a rhythm and blues brother, I'm old school. But we all have various ways in which we keep track of the creativity and the humanity of poor people. And in America, we have a very rich tradition of unbelievable genius coming from poor sections of town. Mm-hmm. It could be chocolate, vanilla, yellow, red with our indigenous brothers and sisters. So music is not a plaything. That's how we preserve mm-hmm. our sense of sanity and dignity and telling the truth, even if many of our leaders don't specialize in telling the truth.
Yes.
And by truth, I'm not just talking about propositions, I'm talking about the life that you live, the values you enact, the vision that you pursue. The condition of truth is to allow suffering to speak, and the music, the artistic delicacy in the face of the social misery, keeps us attuned to the truth. Give the band another hand. Give the band another hand. That's what we're hearing in your music. That's what we're hearing in your music.
Jeff, the national audience watching, listening right now, didn't hear the first number that you did, but Doc and I looked at each other and our eyes popped open when we heard the lyrical content of that first song. I thought I heard something about the 99 and the 1. What were the lyrics of that first song you all did for
us? You're talking about the 1% have more of the wealth than the 90% combined, yet millions live in poverty. It's time we realigned. Yeah, when I heard I was invited and I could get some people together to play with me here today, I wrote that song for today, based on what you have taught over your radio show and also what has been coming out through other centers, including Child Watch and Marion Wright Edelman.
Oh, yes, absolutely. Children's Defense Fund. Yeah, her husband Peter, who founded the Children's Defense Fund with her, Peter Edelman would be with us tomorrow. Sister Marion's traveling, so she couldn't join us. But when we get to the D.C. area tomorrow, Alexandria, Virginia, Peter Edelman and Ralph Nader and others will be with us. But Peter Edelman, who founded that with his wife, the Children's Defense Fund, many years ago, will be with us. Doc, what say you about artists today? And whether or not in this moment they are stepping up to let their voices be heard, given the wonderful opening you gave us a moment ago. I think of Bruce Springsteen and a few others. But
yeah, Brother Bruce.
What are the artists having to say right now, to your mind, about this issue of poverty in America? We don't seem, to me at least, to have that folk high standard that we had back in the day.
Well, I think the tradition is alive, it's just not well. You got Lupe Fiasco, Brother Ali, Erykah Badu, Bruce Springsteen, Bob Dylan just dropped his 35th album. He's still telling some deep truths. But it's very difficult for an artist these days to deal with the recording, radio, and the video industry. They're all run by the same oligarchs. Mm-hmm. That's why you got the 7-Eleven music, music with seven words and hear it 11 times. No story, no narrative, no depth. Just staying on the surface, so that, you know, when Ashford and Simpson talking about give me something real, don't hold your breath for the cotton candy music these days. And that's a sad thing, because it reflects the spiritual impoverishment of our young people. And they need music with depth that tells truths, that actually has harmony and rhythm and voices together. See, hip-hop doesn't have a tradition of voices harmonizing together the way LaVert sang with Gerald and Sean and the others. What it means to sing together, listen to one another, and respond to what you're listening to. So that's a very rich tradition. And when you lose that, then you're in the world all by yourself, isolated, ego, how I'm going to get over. Yeah. And then they look in our society and say, oh, it's the 11th commandment, thou shalt not get caught. That's the major norm these days. Get over it by any means, as much money and pleasure as you can get before you die. He who is the richest ends with the most material toys. How empty, how shallow. Thank God for Brother Jeff Moyers and the band keeping the tradition alive. But Brother Jeff, we also know you're a long distance runner in the struggle for freedom for everybody, but also for our physically challenged brothers and sisters. You want to say a quick word about your work there?
I've been the troubadour of the disability rights movement for many years. And by the way, Marion Wright Edelman was one of the key people that started the movement towards civil rights, the rights for children, the Education for All Handicapped Children Act back in the 73. It was her study about poverty and children in America. You know, poverty and disability are intertwined. People with disabilities have the highest unemployment rate and are among the poorest and the most disenfranchised from everyday matters in American life. And when you talk about poverty, you're talking about the life of many, many people with disabilities. But my music has been working in schools, teaching about tolerance, not just about kids with disabilities, but all difference, whether it's color, whether it's disability, whether it's nationality. I had a couple kids come up and say we're the kids that are ridiculed in this school because we're from Iran. And it's when we can see the level playing field that all people have that intrinsic, we are created equal. Not that we can do all things equally well, but that we in fact have been given that God-given spirit. And when we can see it in each other and work to enliven it, that's when we are going to be reaching the American dream. I pledge allegiance. My liberty, your freedom, it's one thing, but we have to be concerned about everyone's freedom or there is no liberty.
I got 30 quick seconds here, Jeff. I hope I'm not putting you on the spot too much, but just in a quick 30 seconds, there's a reason why you're sitting in that chair. You made the note, you made the point of the connection between disability and poverty. There's a reason why you're in that chair. You got 30 seconds, can you tell me right quick?
I donated a kidney a couple of years ago, and like many people, 100 million people in America are in chronic pain, and many people who are kidney donors do live with chronic pain, and I can't sit or stand for long, but I can be in this reclining wheelchair and keep playing and keep teaching.
Donated a kidney.
It's amazing, brother.
Special brother.
It's amazing, that's true.
Jeff Moyer.
Keeping that love alive.
So
keeping
here's Jeff Moyer, the band.
Alive, brother. I'm telling
As they
you,
give
man.
Us a little music, we're going to let you know what's coming up after this short break. We're going to have our leaders roundtable. We're going to feature a city councilman here in the city of Cleveland. We're going to feature our dear friend, George Fraser, the chairman and CEO of FraserNet. That councilman's name, by the way, is Brian Cummings. He does have a name. And we're going to be joined also from Capitol Hill live by Congresswoman Marcy Kaptur. That's all coming up in just a moment. So stay with us for the first stop in Cleveland, Ohio of the Poverty Tour 2.0.
So many children on the street, they just don't have enough to eat. Keep your eye on the prize and hold on. Children in poverty, tax cuts for aristocracy. Keep your eye on the prize and hold on. Hold on. You gotta hold on. Keep your eye on the prize and hold on. 16 million kids in poverty, tax cuts for aristocracy. Keep your eye on the prize and hold on. Poor people are at risk each day. Can't see, the doctor just can't pay. Keep your eye on the prize and hold on. Hold on. Keep your eye on the prize. Hold on.
We're back live in Cleveland, Ohio.
Yeah.
The first stop on a four Battleground State Poverty Tour. We're calling this the Poverty Tour 2.0. Last year, Dr. West and I went to 18 cities on this poverty tour that was recorded by the same guys you see with these cameras in our face right now. A project called the Media Mobilizing Project, a project that works, in fact, with a lot of poor people based out of Philadelphia to teach them how to do media broadcast work. So we brought them on the tour with us, and that became a week-long, five-night special
on, your show?
On PBS. Yeah, we had a five-night special about poverty in America that was recorded during our tour last year. And then earlier this year, we put out a book, Dr. West and I, for all the things we've done together, never have written a book together until this year. The book is called The Rich and the Rest of Us, A Poverty Manifesto. The Rich and the Rest of Us, A Poverty Manifesto, came out earlier this year, just a few months ago, hit number 7 in the New York Times bestseller list. So people, first time in 40, 50 years since Michael Harrington's book, I think, that a book about poverty specifically was on the New York Times bestseller list. We were honored by that. But we went back out for another 20, 25 cities, I think, on that tour, talking about poverty. So now here we are in the midst of this intense presidential campaign, unapologetically, on the very day that the official poverty numbers come out, kicking off the Poverty Tour 2.0, putting us back on the road in various battleground states. So we're delighted to be here in Cleveland, Ohio for the first stop. I should mention that this radio broadcast is being heard all week live and around the country thanks to Pacifica and Native Voice One. Please thank Pacifica and Native Voice One for carrying these broadcasts live to the nation over public radio. That's why I'm proud to be on public radio. That's why I love WCPN and public radio and public television at their best, make America better. So we're delighted to be heard by them. Time now for a conversation with some leaders. We're going to talk to a variety of people over the next 4 or 5 days on this tour, but we're delighted now to be joined by three persons here in person with us in Cleveland. Our friend, City Councilman Brian Cummins. Please welcome Councilman Cummins to the show. Also, delighted to be joined by an old friend. I didn't mean to call you old, but a friend I've known for a long time. Our friend George Fraser, the chairman and CEO of FraserNet, based in Cleveland. Please welcome George Fraser. And pleased to be joined, I believe, on the phone from Capitol Hill by your Congresswoman Marcy Kaptur. Congresswoman, are you there?
I am there, and thank you so much for bringing your magnificent program to Cleveland.
Please welcome your Congresswoman Marcy Kaptur to this program. Congresswoman, let me start with you. As you well know, Ohio is the ultimate in battleground states. As goes Ohio, so goes the nation. The truth of the matter is that if Mr. Romney can't figure out a way to win here in Ohio, it makes really, really short, kind of like his road to victory. It dries up really fast if he can't figure out how to make it here in Ohio. So that Mr. Obama and Mr. Romney want to win Ohio. Both have taken up residency in this state. How important is Ohio in terms of how this election will turn out, and more importantly, how will poverty, how will the economy factor into what happens here in Ohio?
Well, obviously, Ohio is very
important. I'm sorry, Congressman, please, go ahead, please.
Thank you. Ohio is vital. It's the make or break state in this presidential election, and every vote in Ohio has added meaning and added power. And we have to work very hard to make sure that our votes are cast properly and fairly, and that they are counted in each of our counties. And I could very quickly just say that if you looked at the gerrymandering that was done in the recent congressional redistricting, you will see that every urban county in Ohio was shattered. The urban counties are represented largely by Democrats. Every sitting incumbent Republican's home county was kept whole. There is a real effort in the gerrymandering that was done to try to suppress the vote, and gerrymandering was a part of the equation that faces us as we move toward the election in November.
How serious is the issue of poverty in your district in the state of Ohio? What kind of expectation do the people of Ohio have from the next president of this country where the economy is concerned?
Oh, the economy is the number one issue. If you look at Cleveland and the other major communities I hopefully will represent, Lorain and Toledo, they have poverty rates above the national average. It is a very, very serious situation. We have many people who are unemployed, who have fallen off their benefits. We have many senior citizens who have fallen into deeper poverty because of rising prices for food and basic necessities of life. And so all across the northern part of Ohio, even though the economy is recovering slowly, and we welcome that in every sector, nonetheless, we have so many people that have not been able to keep a solid footing during this very difficult time. You know, even if you have a savings account, it doesn't pay anything in terms of interest. So our seniors, if they have certificates of deposit, they have no earnings. And it's making life very, very difficult. The poorest people in Ohio today are women over the age of 80.
Mm-hmm. You know, we were walking the streets of Quincy and Morehouse last night just to always go to the section of town where folk are struggling. And I say to myself that these vicious, racist attempts to suppress votes on the one hand, and yet on the other hand, trying to tell the truth about the poverty. Let's turn to Brother Brian Cummins. What kind of truths ought we to tell about poverty?
Well, I think for here in Cleveland, on a very local level, I represent 25,000 people in the city of Cleveland, and I have the highest amount of Hispanic voters and residents in my district. And you know, I think in terms of poverty, as the Congresswoman said, there's really been a continued concentration of poverty in our urban centers. And particularly hard hit are, of course, people of color. Blacks and Hispanics as groups generally are much harder hit, not only in poverty, but obviously also in health disparities as well. So it's a very combined problem, and it's been very long-standing. We've been in a kind of a recessionary downturn in Ohio for over a decade, So people have been pummeled in the crisis that we've just seen in terms of the banking, housing foreclosure, et cetera, has just really been detrimental as well. So it's been very difficult.
You were a friend of Occupy. They certainly looked to you for leadership and for support when they were in full swing. Assess to me right quickly what Occupy did to put the issue of economic injustice, the issue of poverty, on the front burner. What did they do to aid and abet that conversation? And what happens now that people think that that movement has, if not fizzled, at least, you know, abated?
Well, it's a tough question in terms of what happens. I mean, in the inception, I think it really gave a lot of hope in that most activists in activist organizations really try to focus on specific issues that they feel that they can make a difference on. Too little, though, is done to try to combine and consolidate and explain in some thoughtful manner and speak out on some thoughtful manner relative to the overall effects of these issues. And too often activists and organizations don't get together enough, or that message isn't really played out as well as you're doing it and through your new book. So I think the future is very hard to say. I think when you're dealing with poverty, people are working several jobs or not working and looking for jobs, several jobs. Mm-hmm. It's difficult for them to find their voice and to be active. And we had a very diverse group within Occupy, some very difficult times that we went through. I thought if any city in America needed an Occupy movement, it would be Cleveland, Ohio, primarily because of what we're going through right now, through our state budgets and other issues, and what we've been through in terms of our economic malaise over the last 10 years.
Mm. George Fraser is the chairman and CEO of FraserNet, Inc. I've known George for years, as has Dr. West.
Absolutely.
And we've worked with George over the years. We didn't want to come to Cleveland and not see him. First of all,
he's a legend.
He's a legend. He is indeed. Want to give him a hug, first of all, but to get his insights. George, let me just jump in right quick with you, because you are a business owner. Mm-hmm. You have about 8 or 10 employees, I think. Mm-hmm. So you are a small business owner, and if anybody has been hurt in this recession, it's small business. And I'm trying to get a sense of how you've navigated this, and I got a couple of follow-ups I want to ask, and I'm sure Doc wants to jump in as well. But just talk to me from, you wear so many hats, but from the hat of, talk to me from that hat of being a small business owner and trying to navigate this economy and the issues of poverty and the struggles of your employees.
Well, as a small business owner today, I've had to take on the persona of a Miles Davis or a John Coltrane. I've had to improvise. Mm-hmm. Right? We have been in business for 25 years as a small minority-owned business serving black communities. And so our business has been significantly impacted by the economy. Mm-hmm. With the pushback and pullback of corporate support for many of the things that we do. It has been significantly impacted by participation and attendance in the things that we provide our community, because people just don't have the resources to get there, to be a part of something greater than themselves. But we have still nonetheless spend our time and resources focusing on what can we do as an African American owned business to facilitate and to provide new models, new skills, and new tools for our people to address the issue of poverty in our community, which has only gotten wider and deeper in the last 30 years. So we look at and prepare products and services to deal with the issue of effective education in our community. We do not have, urban education is not effective at this moment in time. So we produce products and services that help us to make urban education more effective. The other thing that I'm tremendously concerned about, Tavis and Dr. West, is the literacy. Literacy. That's different than effective education. You see, you can graduate from high school, but if you can't read your own diploma, you've got a real problem. And so I'm really concerned about reading and literacy, specifically in the black and brown community. And if you look at all the indices in America, we just don't read as well as we need to be reading. There's a little emphasis on that, and I think that has to be fixed. I think also we provide products and services in our community to help our people get back to the basics. We, in a sense, have lost our way. I mean, I'm a foster child, grew up 14 years in foster homes with, you know, 11 children, grew up in a family of Brooklyn, New York, with 11 children. And our foster parents, my sister Emma and myself and my younger brother, we grew up under four basic principles that saved our lives, okay? Number one, our foster parents said, you will get a high school diploma or you will get out of this house, all right? That was number one. Right? If your behind goes to jail, you're going to stay there. Okay? Mm-hmm. No question about that. The other basic tenet is that you will not bring no babies in this house. Right? You will not bring no babies in this house. And the final one is that leaders are readers, so turn off the damn television. Now, that's what they told us. Those are the four
strong,
basic things.
Strong moral and discipline.
And those basic things saved my life. The last one especially, leaders are readers, turn off the television. And Ms. Lambert, my fourth grade teacher, focused on reading with me, and I fell in love with reading. I then fell in love with learning, and that saved me from a life of poverty and a life of mediocrity. And we must focus on literacy in combination with effective education.
Yes. Well, I know, of course, you've just written a book for young people. But even beyond that, though, if we talk about just the system itself, because you think increasing unemployment among college graduates, increasing unemployment among MAs and PhDs, the system itself, even given what you rightly talk about, the need for literacy and moral sensibility and so forth, needs to be highlighted. I mean, if someone were to come down from Mars and look at our system and say, this system is not working for poor people, it's working well for investment bankers, it's working well for Wall Street, there's deeper issues of justice here that require courageous truth-telling, witness-bearing, and organizing. And that might be long run, because I mean, we got to deal with where we are now.
That's right.
But that kind of honesty seems to be lacking these days in public discourse.
There's no question about that. That's why I want to compliment you and Tavis in the words of President Clinton at the Democratic National Convention for having the brass to take on this challenge and to stay this course and to make this a topic of conversation in a pivotal presidential year. And just understand that if it was easy, why would God need you? So I ask you to stay the course. This is not easy. This is a very difficult subject. When I blasted this poverty call to consciousness tour with Tavis and Cornel West to the 50,000 people in our network, I got lots of people. I told Tavis this earlier, you know, Dr. Fraser, why are you doing that? I said, because it's right. It's right. They are right. And this needs to be brought to the surface. It has to bubble to the surface. Someone has to have the courage to do it.
I want to come back to you, George, in just a second and pick up on this notion of why it is, to your wonderful example of the pushback you got when you just e-blast your list that you were coming to be a part of a conversation about poverty. You got some pushback from certain folk. That has been especially true in the African-American community. But more broadly, poverty is such an impolitic topic. It seems to be you're impolite to raise the issue of poverty in public. Hence, the Democrats and the Republicans don't really want to talk about it at their conventions. We'll come back to that thought in just a second. But while we got the Congresswoman on the phone, I know she got a lot of work to do on Capitol Hill. We want her to get to work, get back to work on the Hill. But Congresswoman, before you have to leave us in the next few minutes here, one of the things it seems to Dr. West and me that Congress ought to be talking about, and here I want to be very honest in my assessment that the Democrats should have done more about this when they did control the House and the Senate in the first 2 years of Mr. Obama's administration. I want to be clear about my point of view on this. When President Obama ran 4 years ago, he ran on a platform, one, of eradicating poverty. He hadn't gotten around to telling us how he's going to do that in the first term, but I digressed on that point. But he also ran on a platform of saying he wanted to raise the minimum wage to $9.50 an hour. He campaigned really hard on raising the minimum wage. Why can't we get a real conversation in this country, not about a minimum wage, but about a living wage? And why is Congress not taking up the issue of raising the minimum wage?
I think in the current Congress, the answer would be that it would be dead-ended in the House. And in the Senate, they would have a filibuster. I think it's worth the fight. We have so many working Americans who work for the current minimum wage but live in poverty and qualify for supplemental nutrition assistance, our program to help people purchase nutritious food. So we've got so many people who are working but simply can't afford to live in this country. So it is a very debilitating situation that they face. In addition to that, we know that at our food banks in Cleveland and around the country, we've had a 20% increase in the number of seniors going into our food banks for help because the prices have gone up so much they can't afford to live. And as I mentioned before, they're not earning anything on any savings they might have. So if we look at the challenge America faces in the large context, we've probably lost 5 million jobs due to our trade deficit, where jobs have been outsourced to other countries, and we're getting all these imports on our shelves, and we're literally pitting our workers against people who are working for starvation wages in the developing nations of the world. They have no rights there. There was just a big story in the New York Times this week about Bangladesh and how the women workers there are being treated. It's a terrible situation. And we have no labor rights built into the trade agreements that are being negotiated, whether it's NAFTA, whether it's China, whether it's this new agreement they want to have in Asia. We literally are faced with the inability to have a real debate on minimum wage in this country, but more importantly, we do not tie our trade agreements to a rising standard of living and labor rights around the world, and it is a real problem. It is a race to the bottom here in the United States.
One last question, though, because I just tribute to the work you do, and Brother Tavis and I are very clear that Brother Barack Obama would be much better than Mitt Romney in terms of poverty, but that's not saying a whole lot. The bar is pretty low. Why was it that there was not more discussion about poverty at the Democratic National Convention in Charlotte?
I think because the economy is the top issue that's on the public's minds, the fact that
but
our country...
But poverty is part of the economy.
It's part of the economy, but I think that it's viewed as almost untouchable because you're talking about what isn't fixed yet, and we want to always be on the positive side and talk about what's been fixed and the economy's growing. And if you look at the poverty piece of this, there's a somewhat of denial during, you know, a sparkling convention that this is actually a part of our country. And I want to compliment you on raising consciousness. I remember back when Michael Harrington did his book many years ago.
The Other America, indeed.
The Other America, and raise the consciousness of the nation. That is what you are doing. If you just give me one more minute, let me say, in every family, the most important dollar they have is their food dollar. In every neighborhood in America, hundreds of thousands of dollars are there, either through their Social Security checks, their veterans checks, for those that qualify and are working, obviously, their own wages, and then their SNAP benefits for nutrition assistance. I'm so excited by what Councilman Cummins is doing and others in Cleveland in allowing local production of food in places like Ohio City, for example. And you're seeing people being able to spend their food dollar inside their own neighborhoods. There's a neighborhood empowerment that's beginning to take root in Northern Ohio to rechannel those food dollars in a way that help to move money back. Over 7% of Ohioans are unbanked. They don't even have a checking or savings account. If we can find a way for them to procure good food in neighborhoods close to home, and the First Lady is very interested in this, and also produce some of that food in high-tech facilities in Cleveland, we are going to begin to move that money circle back close to the families themselves. And I think some of the work that's being done in Cleveland with the community development corporations, with credit unions. It's too much to explore in this program, but I'd love to come back and talk about it.
Yeah.
Because I can see the future, and we could use these dollars so much more wisely.
The longest serving woman in the House, Congresswoman Marcy Kaptur. Please thank her for joining us.
Thank you,
Congresswoman,
so
thank you for your time.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. God
and
bless
for your
you
work
your
on
audience.
The Hill.
Thank you very much.
You.
If you're just tuning in, we are live in Cleveland, Ohio, about to go to a break here in just a second for a moment, but we're live in Cleveland, Ohio on the very first stop of what is a four battleground state poverty tour 2.0. In a moment, when we come back, we'll continue our conversation for the rest of this hour with Cleveland City Councilman Brian Cummins and our friend George Fraser, CEO and chairman of FraserNet. This program, the Poverty Tour 2.0, is distributed by Pacifica and Native Voice One.
Full of wonder, idly ponder all that you're seeing and feeling. I gently enfold you. Of caring, really you're sharing. All that is flowing is showing the trust that's within you. As your life unfolds, secrets that it holds, this will remain in joy and in pain. The need for love will remain the same. Caring, all that is flowing is showing the trust that's within.
We're back live in Cleveland, Ohio. We are at the Ideastream Westfield Insurance Studio Theater at the Idea Center. Delighted to be here on the very first leg of what is a four battleground state. Try that in English, Tavis. A four battleground state tour, starting in Ohio, then to Virginia, then to Pennsylvania, and on to Florida. So if you are, if you want to log on to smileyandwest.com at any time, smileyandwest.com, you can find out where we are. Follow us on the tour. We again thank Pacifica and Native Voice One for making this program possible over public radio. And we want to thank HuffPost Live, for being our media sponsor as well. We were talking just before the break, Doc, to the Congresswoman Marcy Kaptur, the longest serving woman in the House,
mm-hmm.
Who had to get back to work on the Hill, and that's a good thing. But we're still pleased to be joined now by Cleveland City Councilman Brian Cummins and by our friend George Fraser. I know Doc has a question he wants to ask you, Councilman, but I want to go back to George first, where I left you hanging a few minutes ago.
Mm-hmm.
And just have an honest conversation. All of our conversations are honest. But you hit on something a moment ago that I want to go right at, specifically inside the African-American community,
mm-hmm.
that you've been super serving, not just serving, but super serving for so long as a small business owner. There is something inside of our community that has made it impolitic to talk about this issue. And if I had the time, I could run down all the reasons and all the excuses that Doc and I have been given specifically by black folk why we ought not be raising this issue on Obama's watch, given what he's already up against. Now, never mind the fact that black people disproportionately are catching the most hell, but there's something wrong with Doc and me for even raising the conversation on Mr. Obama's watch. Now, you got some of that pushback when you sent out an email, an e-blast to your 50,000 list that you shouldn't be hanging out with two mongrels like Smiley and West. So how did you take that pushback, number one? And more broadly, what do you say about how inside our own community, you wrote the book, Success Runs in Our Race,
mm-hmm.
not lately.
Mm-hmm.
So what do you say about this moment that we find ourselves in inside of Black America? It's a strange moment, man.
It is a very strange moment, but there's a ray of hope. If you watch the Democratic Convention, and I watched it intently, for the first time, Bill Clinton gave a major, masterful speech. He mentioned the word poor and poverty 11 times. I never heard that before. And for the first time, if you listen to President Obama's speech, he mentioned the word poor and poverty twice. okay? This is a first. So there's a ray of hope here. And I think that once this election is, in quote, over, and President Obama is reelected, and I do believe he will be reelected, this topic, this ugliness will be faced. I really believe that. Now, why are we so funny, black folk, about talking about this subject? It's like if you're really ugly, you really don't want to look in the mirror, right? Right? Now, you may not think you're ugly, but you know, you really don't want to look at it. So this is an ugly thing. This is something that has impacted us disproportionately, certainly over the last 30 years. The gap between blacks and whites in America, and almost every indice, and certainly economic, every indice, employment, is as wide as it's ever been. We have spiraled downward in the last 30 years. If Dr. King were to come back here, he would be ecstatic that President Obama is a president. He predicted that. And he would be angry with us about every single thing else. We're at the bottom of every single statistic that matters in America. And I think it is because we are living our values outside of our culture. I think one of the solutions to poverty for black and brown people is to stop living our values outside of our culture. We work hard for everybody else except for us, right? There's no question about that. Whatever we produce for black people, it's okay for black people. It's not okay for white people, but it's okay for black people. You know, we have to fix this. There's some fundamental systemic things that have gone awry in our community. It has been exacerbated, certainly, by the lack of emphasis on fixing the urban education system. The urban education system is in shambles. And until that is fixed, until literacy is fixed in our community, we are going to continue to lose a generation or two of our children. Not all, but most, right? Yes. And so this is a very hard thing to deal with, a very complex problem.
But you know what, tell me what you think about this though, brother. I think another factor is Martin King, Ella Baker, Fannie Lou Hamer, when they saw precious poor children, and especially on the chocolate side, going to jail, dealing with dilapidated housing, they viewed those precious children as their own children.
Mm-hmm.
We got a middle class, a black middle class, that no Shrinking. Longer views Letitia and Jamal as theirs.
That's right.
So if we had black middle class brothers and sisters going to jail at the same level, dealing with the same dilapidated housing, same disgraceful school systems, then they would be putting pressure on Obama because it would be black middle class kids dealing with that. And all of a sudden, they would say, we're not going to get our vote unless you deal with this prison industrial complex.
Right.
You're not going to get our vote unless you deal with this educational system. That as long as now our class divide, mm-hmm. and this is a spiritual and a moral question, because there was a time when our black leadership fundamentally believed that the black poor had the same status as the black middle class and the black upper class. We got leadership now. Look at the prison industrial complex. It is a catastrophe, and not say a mumbling word about it.
But we
that's a spiritual deficit. It's a moral deficit that Martin shed tears about.
Yeah, and we will be judged by how we treat the least among us. There's no question about that.
I'm not trashing the black middle class, because this is true for the American middle class in general.
Right.
And it's always been true on the vanilla side of town. Oh, indeed, if the precious white children were going to jail at the same level as precious brown and black children, we wouldn't have to worry about putting pressure on Obama. He'd have a town council meeting on the prison industrial complex next week.
Speaking of town council, councilman,
Brother Brian, on a
broader level, beyond this, you know, this black conversation we've been having, why is it that in America, the conversation of poverty is so impolitic? George mentioned the number of times that Bill Clinton used the word poor or poverty, 11, he's right about that. He mentioned the number of times that Barack Obama mentioned poor poverty. He mentioned it twice. Go to the New York Times. They've got a word search application that is one of the best. Doc and I looked at it this morning. The Democrats mentioned the word poor or poverty 3 times for every 25,000 words. Poor or poverty were mentioned 3 times for every 25,000 words at their convention. Democrats, 3 for every 25,000 words, 3 times. Republicans mentioned poor or poverty. Ready for this? 5 times for every 25,000 words. 5 times. Now, just mentioning it, obviously, pardon my English, ain't the answer. But you take my point, Councilman. The Republicans mentioned the word poor or poverty more time than the Democrats mentioned poor or poverty, and they're supposed to be the ones who, you know, are pushing for the eradication of poverty, care about working people, et cetera, et cetera. My point is very clear. I'm not jumping up and down about 3 or 5 times. I'm not celebrating either one, but something is wrong in this country. We can't get traction on a real conversation about poverty. In the body politic more broadly, sir, why is that?
Well, first of all, maybe one of your staff can find out how many times either party, the two major parties, use the word middle class. Because it's becoming a code word. Everything's fine. If you're in the middle class, you're going to be able to rise up. You're going to be able to be rich. Buy those lottery tickets. We just opened a casino in Cleveland, one of the poorest cities in the nation. But the words middle class are a code word, and they're being used by both parties. You two have to be commended because you're bringing a voice to these issues. I don't think it was mentioned yet, but I'm actually a member of the Green Party.
I was going to ask you about that because you switched.
I was legally able to switch only 2 years ago. I worked with Ralph Nader in 2000, but it took this long to get even the Supreme Court in Ohio to rule that trying to become a party was too hard constitutionally. And they allowed us finally party status only 2 years ago, along with the Libertarians. Democrats and Republicans generally don't want to hear any other voices, and it's a real problem. In terms of poverty, you know, I think it was shameful and disgraceful, and I have the utmost respect for Congresswoman Capter, but I think it's disgraceful to see Obama's record and the Democrats' record on that minimum wage issue. President Obama made a promise in 2008 to see it increased. You know, you didn't mention it, but I know you had our good friend Ralph Nader on a few weeks ago who mentioned it, that the adjusted minimum wage from 1968 to date would be something like 1036, I believe.
That's right.
At least
1036.
Exactly.
And when someone asked about that to their congresswoman or congressperson, they said, well, why do you want that benefit? Why do you want that? Like it's an entitlement. People are working at these lowest wages, and they have to be able to earn what their worth is. And by the way, from 68 to today, we've got double the productivity.
Yeah. Councilman, I hate to cut you off.
And the profits high at the top.
I hate to cut the councilman off because he's on a road now. Please thank Councilman Brian Cummins for being here.
Absolutely.
Please thank George Fraser for being here. This is the Poverty Tour 2.0, distributed by Pacifica and Native One, Native Voice One.
Joe Yablonski, and I work right at the rim, heaving ore into the steel at the edge where hell begins. Fiery steel is forged in Cleveland town. Death claims a greedy price for making God fire on the earth. For steel as cold as ice. When the siren screams there on the ship, it's death some worker knowed. The wailing of the siren marks the passing of the soul. It's a devil's cut in Cleveland town. Good men will lose their lives while the bosses call the next in line.
From Cleveland, Ohio's Ideastream Westfield Insurance Studio Theater at the Idea Center, I'm Tavis Smiley.
And I'm Cornel West, and this is the Poverty Tour 2.0.
In this hour, our Solutions Roundtable focusing on the innovative ideas successful in alleviating poverty.
We'll learn from the courageous activism of the Justice for Janitors campaign, where folks are straightening up their backs and demanding fair wage.
And we'll talk to the worker owners of the Evergreen Cooperative. Received a lot of attention lately. They're creating jobs without any help from the 1%.
Plus two sisters who came all the way from Youngstown, Ohio to be with us will share their story of going from prison to stability.
It's all this hour in Cleveland, Ohio on the Poverty Tour 2.0.
Hits the steel of his molten metal grave. The bosses and the owners gathered riches none can tell, but their wages for eternity. Just the boiling steel of hell. For steel, hot steel. Created equal, are we all? A sounding for the ages, a stirring sacred call, but not a promise, not reality. Did Jefferson inscribe, for its want so many suffered, for its want so many died, and it's on toward our common dignity. In a land whose great promise we now keep, civil rights and an equal open door, as we pass where so many trod before. Lincoln guided toward that yearning with the slave's emancipation, but a bloody road still laid ahead for those freed within our nation. And then women took their rightful place. Sweet suffrage, hard won. 2008's historic milestones. See how far we've come. And it's on toward our common dignity. In a land whose great promise we now keep. Civil rights and an equal open door, as we pass where so many trod before. Then civil strife and native rights, freedom's flame burned ever higher, and then movements aimed at access, a torch of truth's own fire, out of bleak and barren shadowlands. The wailing of the storm, the wind unfurled our banners, a better day, brighter morn, and it's on toward our common dignity. In a land whose great promise we now keep, civil rights and an equal open door. As we pass where so many trod before, to the bridge, equal, we are created equal, given life, given liberty and more. Equal, we are created equal, our Creator gave us rights none can ignore. Yes, we are created equal, intrinsic rights endowed, all the same beneath the surface, gifts bestowed on one and all, and these battered truths. self-evident, pass through time from hand to hand. May our leaders join our purpose, and full access will expand. And it's on toward our common dignity. In a land whose great promise we now keep, civil rights and an equal open door, as we pass where so many trod before, as we pass where so many trod before.
I'm Tavis Smiley.
I'm Cornel West.
And we are in Cleveland.
Cleveland, Ohio.
Cleveland, Ohio, for the very first stop on what is a four Battleground State Poverty Tour 2.0. We start today in Ohio. We will head then to Virginia and to Pennsylvania and to Florida. And you can learn all the details about this Poverty Tour 2.0 at our website, smileyandwest.com. In the last election for the White House, in the 2008 election, Doc, you recall, those three debates between Obama and McCain, the word poor or poverty did not come up one time. Obama never raised it in three debates. McCain never raised it in three debates. The moderators never asked about it. Three presidential debates, the word poor or poverty didn't come up one time in 2008. The first presidential debate of this season will be October the 3rd. Two of the moderators that didn't get around to talking about poverty 4 years ago are back on the stage again this year. And so this tour is about a lot of things, but one of the things it's about is pushing the moderators at these upcoming presidential debates to make sure that poverty gets on the agenda. We cannot abide another campaign for the White House, another debate season where the issue of poor people in America just don't even get discussed. And so today, in fact, in Washington, as we speak, I'm just told they're still in press conference right now, but literally right now at this moment in the nation's capital, the U.S. Census Bureau is conducting a press conference to release the official poverty numbers today. When you combine the weak job numbers from last Friday with today's poverty numbers, this country is in trouble. Poverty is the new American norm, and so Dr. West and I are delighted and humbled to be back on this tour again, trying to push this issue higher up on the American agenda.
And we have our dear sister Lori Couch and sister Sandra Ellington here. We know that Brother Martin Luther King Jr., at the very end of his life, defending the dignity of the workers in the janitation area. And I'd like to hear your stories and your analysis. Where are things now when you talk about justice for janitors?
Well, justice for janitors, where the working class Americans can have a living wage, not to be ashamed of what you do and where you live. To be given a fair chance, you know, not to be ashamed, not to say, oh, you clean. I'm not ashamed of what I do, but I believe and I know and I deserve a decent wage. Mm-hmm. And you know, the face of America is starting to change. You know, the manufacturing jobs are gone. So mm-hmm. Wendy's, McDonald's, those jobs are available. And the faces look like me. People trying to raise their children and have a home. So the wages and Congress need to know that that has to change. We can't continue to work at these wages, you know. I'm blessed, you know, I'm in a union. I have somebody to fight.
SEIU.
Yeah, SEIU, local one, definitely. Out of Chicago.
Yeah.
And I worry about my brother and sister. I can't just think about myself. You know, my grandmother always said, if you have two loaves of bread and your neighbor is hungry, give them a loaf. They're only asking for a loaf of bread. And we can, as Americans, if we can, we can do this in this country. There has to be a necessary change. Poverty in my neighborhood where I live looks like dilapidated homes, people squatting because they have nowhere to live, children at the grocery store, not just, you know, you would get the groceries and you wanted to buy candy, but when a child comes to you and say, can I take your groceries to the car so I can buy something to eat, it does something to your heart, because you can look at the face, that could be your child at any moment. So poverty, you know, and justice for Janet, that's what it is for me. It's a fight every day for my brother and sister. I will not stop just because I have a little more. I will try to give as much as I can.
I know Lori's gonna join in here as well. Before she does though, since you mentioned this, Sandra, I was just reading literally on the plane coming in here last night. I mean, Doc and I are devouring, you know, we always do. He's much more of a voracious reader even than I am, because he's a professor. He has to be prepared for class every day. And I got to be prepared to go on the radio and TV every night. But so we're always reading stuff. And I was reading a report that came out just a few days ago, to your point, Sandra, from the USDA, so the Agriculture Department, United States Department of Agriculture. The Ag Department put out a study just the other day, Doc, you may have seen this, about food insecurity in this country. The numbers completely blew me away. 50 million Americans, these numbers just came out a couple of days ago, you can find it online, 50 million Americans will go to bed tonight without enough food to eat. 50 million Americans will go to bed tonight without enough food to eat. It gets worse. 9 million of those are children. Tonight in America, as we sit here in Cleveland today, 9 million children, some in Ohio, are going to go to bed tonight without having had enough food to eat this day. 9 million children. That is the equivalent, just to give you a visual of what this is, that's the equivalent of the state of California and Illinois combined. Just imagine the entire state of California, the entire state of Illinois going to bed tonight without enough food to eat. That's what we're up against in this country. So when you said that story of kids asking you if they can uptake your groceries to the car so they can get some money to buy themselves something to eat, you know, I think that we're so used to seeing these infomercials about poverty and hunger in the third world that we don't realize in this country, 50 million people, 9 million children will go to bed tonight without enough food to eat. Just wanted to mention that since you raised that issue, because that number was in my head, because it was startling when I saw that last night. But Lori, tell me your struggle and your work with SEIU to put this issue of justice for janitors front and center for the American public.
So I work for SEIU Local 1, Janitors Union here in Cleveland. I work in Cincinnati, and we represent janitors in Cincinnati as well. The problem that we see and that we're all facing is it's not just unemployment. Unemployment is certainly part of the problem, but all the people that are living in poverty, all the kids that are going to bed hungry, it's not just because of unemployment, it's because the jobs that are available now do not pay a living wage. Mm-hmm. And you guys hit on that earlier when you talked about why aren't we talking about a living wage, you know, in addition to talking about the minimum wage. Sandra mentioned this earlier, and this is exactly what the issue is. The jobs that are available now, well, the jobs that built our country's urban cores, cities like Cleveland, were manufacturing jobs. They weren't good jobs either until people organized, they raised standards. You didn't need to come from a rich family. You didn't need to have gone to college to be able to support your family. If you had a job, you could support your family. You could own a home. You could send your kids to college. And those jobs built our cities. They built cities like Cleveland. Now we don't have those jobs anymore. What we have increasingly, the vast majority of the job growth is service sector jobs, and these are majority low wage, no benefit jobs. And if it stays that way, we're just going to keep seeing the ranks of people who are living in poverty growing.
Say 40% of the new jobs now are low-wage jobs. So this issue of a living wage that has something to do with the dignity of workers, acknowledged, has to be front and center. Of course, we're dealing with international global market where the companies go to Mexico, China, India, and other places where the wages are lower, and therefore they make it difficult for unions to have the kind of strength that unions ought to have. And right now, unions are being scapegoated across the board. Look at what's going on in Chicago with the teachers union.
Yep.
In fact, we want the teachers to know in Chicago, we stand in solidarity with you. Yes, we do. And tell Rahm Emanuel that he needs to be accountable to working people. I don't care who he has worked with in the past. Tell him that personally, out of love. But how can we best be of service to the union activity of both of you to support you?
I think that people need to organize. More people need to organize. I mean, Sandra and I, this is what we do. We talk to workers, and we work to organize in industries where people don't have a voice right now, and where jobs are treated like they don't have dignity. This is a big part of the trend, as we see this move towards low-wage service sector work. People are treated like, you know, these are temporary jobs, or these are part-time jobs, or these are after-school jobs for kids. They're not. They're what's holding up our economy now. I mean, Sandra, you were saying just the other day, someone, you were cleaning the bathroom, and they were like, I'm so sorry for you.
I was cleaning, I work in the public sector, and I was cleaning the restroom. That's my job. And she said, I feel so sorry for you. And I was like, what? I was just like kind of put back that she would say that. I was like, no, I wanted to say, no, I feel sorry for you, because I have dignity in the job that I do. You know, I provide a service to this country. Janitors provide a service. You know, I'm not ashamed of what I do. You know, if I was flipping hamburgers, you know, I would not be ashamed. But what it is we have to organize. We need to let them know that if you are working at McDonald's and the boss comes, and you need to have that voice, because without a voice, because I've worked non-union jobs, without a voice, you have nothing, mm-hmm. because they can do what they want. You know, I don't make millions of dollars. I have two children, and they're working. They graduated high school. I did my part in this country, you know, and I deserve my fair share. I'm not going to down anyone that has theirs, but I deserve to have what I'm owed. I'm working. You know, I want to be able to retire. I want to work till I'm 80. Why should I work till I'm 80? I want to enjoy myself. You know, it's hard when people say things like that and they look down on you. Oh, look at that. I'm like, this is my job. I provide a service. Do you understand? If I didn't do it, who would do it? Right. You know, I'm grateful to have SEIU, you know, to have a contract. But people, in order to do something with, to have a good pay or hourly wage, you need to organize. That is the only way. You know, it's hard, and sometimes you have to walk away and walk out the restroom, because are you for real? That's how you feel about me? I should be ashamed? No, I will never be ashamed, because I'm very proud of what I do.
You know, Sandra raised a powerful point, Doc, and I'm curious to get your take on this right quick. Because you recall in our book, The Rich and the Rest of Us, we have a chapter about this. In this book that Doc and I have written, we have a chapter about the psychology of poverty. Yes. The psychology of poverty. And we have, as we argue in the book, Doc, and I'll let you expound on this, but we have in the book argued that because we have so, to Sandra's brilliant point, because we have so demonized and stigmatized and in many instances criminalized the poor, bastardized the poor in this country, that the word poor really is a four-letter word that people don't want to utter publicly, so that there are millions of Americans who are suffering in silence. Yes. They're struggling in silence in their own poverty because they don't want to do what Sandra does. They have a college degree. They didn't expect to be downsized. They've lost their home. They've lost, we argue in the book, that the new poor are the former middle class. And there are a lot of things that they refuse to do, work they don't want to do. They don't feel that they should have to do that. So people suffer in silence because they don't want to be stigmatized as poor because of what we have already done publicly, Doc, right, to demonize the poor.
It, exactly, that demonizing of the poor. But what's fascinating about Sister Sandra is it relates to the music that we were talking about. When you talk about your grandmother,
yes,
and what you learn from her,
oh yes,
you have a spiritual wealth,
oh yes,
that nobody can take away. Part of our problem in our society, we got folk with big money, but a lot of them suffer from spiritual malnutrition and moral underdevelopment. So you can keep a tradition and say, look, I'm going to still give. I'm going to be concerned about the other. I'm going to have my dignity, and your dignity is not predicated on what anybody thinks about you.
That's right.
It's not predicated on how you are treated. And this is a great tradition we get in our music, we get in our language, and it's all colors. And in fact, it's actually international. Again, you find it in every culture, every civilization, but it has to do with your courage, it has to do with your compassion, and it has to do with your vision. And so you become a kind of living embodiment of what we're trying to do on this poverty tour, which is to keep alive this rich humanity, creativity, and courage.
I'm sorry, Doc. We got 30 seconds.
She got me fired up.
Nothing wrong with that. I'm glad you said that. Lori, last word to you right quick. What do you say to people who, there are many in this country, and we saw a mockery being made of unions by some folk at the Republican convention. Mr. Romney himself took a dig at, at unions. What do you say to people who think that the unions are really on their back and that the unions are obsolete these days?
I would point out that it's no coincidence that as the number of working people who have a union has decreased, at the same time, the gap between the richest and the poorest in this country has grown immensely. Unions are that checks and balances system in our economy. It's the only strength that working people have is the strength in numbers. And that's why they fight us. That's why they're afraid of us. That's why they're afraid of working people, because they know when they come together, they can make a difference. And in the past, when they have, it really has.
From the SEIU's Justice for Janitors, please thank Lori Couch and Sandra Ellington for being here. You're listening to The Poverty Tour 2.0 at our first stop in Cleveland, Ohio. This is brought to you by Pacifica and Native Voice One.
I want so badly to begin to feel the wind up against my skin, that I'm bound to be running to leave my city living blues behind. I want to ramble, I'm going to roam and find myself a little happier home. Well, I'm bound to be running to leave my city living blues behind. Well, she made up her face, then made up every bit of my time, made up my mind for me. I said, I got some blues I think I want to leave behind. I want so badly to begin to feel the wind up against my skin, that I'm bound to be running to leave my city living behind. From the top. Hey, Devin.
Welcome back to the Poverty Tour 2.0. We are in Cleveland, Ohio, on day one of our Poverty Tour, taking us to four battleground states: Ohio, Virginia, Pennsylvania, and Florida. I'm Tavis Smiley, and he is
Cornel West.
And so we are on day one, and couldn't be happier. Wish we were here under different conditions and circumstances, but couldn't be more delighted to be back in the great city of Cleveland. We were just having a great conversation. That was powerful, man.
It was so. Very much so.
It was moving, that conversation with those.
Indeed, and her grandmother, the rich legacy that she represents.
Justice for janitors.
Indeed.
Let's talk, as we often do on this radio program and the work that we do about solutions. I get so tired of hearing people, act as if there is no way out of this, that there aren't solutions. Poverty is threatening our democracy, but poverty does not have to be intractable. It's a matter of, Doc and I say all the time, this is not a skill issue, it's a will issue. We have the skill, do we have the will to find solutions to this poverty problem and making it a priority in this country? So now let's talk about some solutions with three guests. Chris Cooper is the program coordinator for the Ohio Employee Ownership Center at Kent State University. Please welcome Chris Cooper to the program. Mary Velvera. Mm-hmm. She's a worker owner of the Green Clean Coop in
Co-op.
I'm sorry, I said coop. Mm. Co-op in Youngstown, Ohio. Yeah. I flew the coop. She's with the co-op. Please welcome Mary to the program. Sleep deprivation. Sleep matters, Brother West. Anyway, and Carl Jacobson is with us as well. Brother Carl, good to have you here as well. Thank you for coming on. Please thank Carl Jacobson for being here as well. So let me start with you, Chris, and tell us quickly about the work that you do, and how it is that we have to push our way to finding some solutions that work to eradicate poverty in this country.
Well, our center is called the Ohio Employee Ownership Center, and mm-hmm. we started back in the '80s in the Northeast Ohio area, primarily working with the industrial companies that were located in, the heavy manufacturing companies that were located in that area at the time. And when a lot of those companies became under stress back in the 80s, mm-hmm. There was a method of what we call employee ownership, an employee stock ownership plan that was created back in the late 70s. And there were some significant tax breaks associated with that plan, with that structure. And as such, it was tried to see if employee ownership could be the key to turning those companies around, primarily from the tax breaks that were available for those companies, made it cheaper to do business in a lot of ways. And plus, with the idea of employee ownership is empowering the employees, motivating the employees, and hopefully creating other benefits like productivity, profitability, and those kind of things that would help turn the company around. And so the ESOP, or the Employee Stock Ownership Plan, for a lot of years has been the primary method of employee ownership in the country. Recently, there's been a greater incidence of employee ownership through what's known as an employee-owned co-op. And cooperatives have a long history in the United States. If you bank at a credit union, for example, you belong to a credit union. A lot of folks in urban communities, they belong to an apartment co-op or some kind of a housing co-op. If you buy your food at some natural food stores, maybe those are food co-ops, those kind of things. So a worker co-op is very similar to that. You know, a cooperative is just a business entity that is owned by its members. And in the case of employee-owned co-op, that would be the employees. Okay, and in the credit union example, it would be the depositors mm-hmm. That would own the co-op. So over the last 5-10 years, we've seen an increase in the use of co-ops. The idea behind an employee stock ownership plan is it is employee ownership, but it's a form of indirect ownership. The ownership is held in a trust on behalf of the employees. So you can create an ESOP with not a lot of participation, not a lot of employee involvement. Essentially, it's another benefit plan. It's a retirement plan, essentially. So the employee owners will receive a benefit from being a member of that ESOP, but they don't necessarily have that, day-to-day control of their workplace that we might see in a co-op. Now, having said that, with ESOPs, there isn't a lot of restrictions on how you want to set up that ESOP. So you can make an ESOP as participatory as a cooperative, for example, but you don't have to, okay? So when we talk about empowering employees, allowing them to generate not just wages, but also capital, right? Because that's the key. You know, we can talk about the minimum wage and, raising the minimum wage is important, but the other piece of wealth creation in this country is capital, right? Access to capital and creation of your own capital. And that's really what employee ownership does. And so with a non-participatory ESOP, which is possible, you still would earn that capital over a period of time, and you would receive it as a retirement benefit when you leave the company. But with an ESOP, you can also be very participatory. There's a number of ESOPs that function just like your average co-op would. A co-op is really democracy, is a very democratic organization by design. Okay, each member has one vote, has one ownership share of the business, okay? So you can still do that with an ESOP, but you don't have to. So that's why co-ops have become kind of like the new edge of employee ownership, employee empowerment. Co-ops tend to be smaller. They're good for a lot of community wealth building opportunities.
You see it increasing and escalating across the nation, right? Democracy spilling over into the work. We had Rick Wolf on this show.
Okay.
His new book, Democracy at Work,
right?
Highlights precisely the kind of thing that you are talking about.
So I mean, research has shown steadily that if you provide employee ownership, if you have employees that own a piece mm-hmm. of the business, mm-hmm. and you also include the employee ownership culture, which is the participation, the decision making. You bring that democracy down to that level. Mm-hmm. You get increases in productivity, profitability, employee turnover is lower, wages are usually higher, benefits are usually better.
What are the challenges? What are the challenges for scaling this up? You suggested earlier over the last 5 or 10 years, we've seen the exponential growth of co-ops in the country as one of the solutions for poverty. But what's the challenge to actually scaling this up across the country?
Well, the issue is, you know, since co-ops are very democratically organized entities, the larger the entity gets, the harder it is to maintain that level of employee involvement, right? And so there's a couple different ways that you can handle that. There's a good example in Spain, for example, the Mondragon cooperatives in Spain serve as a great model for cooperatives in all other regions of the world. And what they've done, and in some regards in Italy too, in various parts of Italy, they've created a network of cooperatives. So the individual entity, the business stays small, but through combining their resources, their capital, their money, all those types of things, their labor pools, you can scale up that way, okay? But there's another option. One of the things that we've been working on is what we call the union cooperative model. And we've been working with that, with the United Steelworkers. A few years ago, the Steelworkers signed an agreement with the Mondragon folks to help bring that model to the United States using union cooperatives. And the idea behind a union cooperative is that co-op gets bigger, okay? And that direct kind of one-on-one management from each individual employee gets a little harder to handle. That union could perhaps come in and fill that role of being a way for maintaining the employee rights, you know, making sure that democracy stays, you know, active.
Oh, now shifting to the green, clean co-op in Youngstown. Would you like to share some with?
Much smaller model.
This is Carl Jacobson, by the way. So go ahead, Carl.
Okay. We are under the umbrella of Beatitude House, which started out as a homeless shelter 20 years ago. It was founded by the Roman Catholic Ursuline nuns. And 3 years ago, seeing the need for employment and understanding poverty, because they have hands-on experience every day, they were looking for a way to lift the women that live with them and their children out of poverty. So they came to the co-op model. What I think is really interesting about the Green Clean model is that the Ursuline sisters actually took $18,000. That was their initial investment in Green Clean. They had a couple used vans. Of course, you need vans if you're going to go around and do cleaning. And they had a facility so they could rent space to the co-op for a very minimal price. But with this $18,000 investment 3 years ago, we now have 12 part-time jobs. Our part-time jobs, we have 10 people of color and two Caucasian gals that are cleaning for us. We are able we have a three-tier wage system. Our employees start at $8 an hour. After they complete an internship of 100 hours, they go to $9.50 an hour. And when they become a co-op owner, they go to $11 an hour. We have profit. Because the way the Ursuline sisters set up this co-op, every cent stays in the co-op. The Ursuline sisters take nothing from the co-op. So they are building capital, profits. Our year will end here at the end of September. The third business year will end at the end of September. And in October, every co-op owner will get a profit check.
And how is business?
Business is good. We doubled our net sales in the last year, and we doubled the salaries that we were able to pay out in the last year, which was wonderful.
Wow. Our dear Sister Mary, the worker and an owner.
Mary Bell, tell them about coming to Green Clean 3 years ago.
When I first started at Green Clean, my first check was of $9. Then I never gave up. I said, this has got to get better. So it sure did. It sure did. Got better for me.
And tell Mr. Smiley how many years you had been looking for work.
5 years. Mm. I was real stressed out.
5 years of looking for work.
Looking
for a
work.
Job.
And how long have you been with Green Cream?
Well, I've been in the Green Cream for 3 to 4 years. I'm going to be there for 4 years now.
She's Maryvale is one of the original people that started with the company.
You're one of the founders. But one of the things that we've been hearing and seeing over the last years of taking these poverty tours and trying to push this issue higher on the agenda are the number of people, Doc, who have been unemployed for years. Again, for those who may be just tuning in, the official poverty numbers come out today. And one of the things that I'm anxious to, as soon as we can get a break, which we can't because this is live, I'm anxious to get to the corner over there to look at the data that's being released literally as we speak in Washington. But we had a good heads up last night of what the numbers are going to indicate. And the numbers are indicating that it's not just the unemployed, Doc, it's obviously increases in the underemployed in this country.
Absolutely.
But for people who've been Sister Mary looking for work for five years, and that's not an uncommon story, that once you lose your job, you go years trying to find something.
Absolutely. But the wonderful thing is that we're seeing the fight back on the ground in a very concrete way. It's part of a Catholic tradition, a very rich tradition, concerned about dignity of labor and the dignity of working people, all of us made in the image of God, all of us made in the likeness of God, and coming out of that Catholic tradition. Secular traditions, workers' cooperatives and so forth. Because a lot of times, even when people look at the data, statistics can tend to discourage us and make us so despairing that we don't recognize that there's many like these three and millions of others who are fighting back in their own distinctive ways. And that's a very important message for our audience. If you're down and out, you got the blues, that's all right. People have been there. You can make it. You can bounce back. Mm-hmm. And that's exactly what we're seeing and hearing in the language of our brothers and sisters here this morning.
I wonder, Chris, how much, to use Doc's phrase, or pick up on it at least, how much bounce back, how much of a trampoline effect can co-ops be for American workers, for everyday people? And I ask that against the backdrop of a conversation I had on my PBS program the other night with Robert Reich, former labor secretary in the Clinton administration. And Secretary Reich made the point that it's not even so much these days a conversation about the social safety net. We know that the social safety net has holes all in it. People are falling through those holes in the social safety net. And in Washington right now, there's more and more talk every day about austerity. So we want to actually pull the good parts, the parts of the safety net that don't have holes in it, we're pulling it up and cutting back programs for those who, through no fault of their own, like Mary, find themselves for 5 years looking for work. What Reich was saying, though, is not about a social safety net. What we need is a trampoline. When you fall down out of the middle class, you hit that trampoline, bang, and you bounce back up. Mm-hmm. You know, you find an opportunity. When you fall down, you just go someplace else, find more work, create another opportunity. You hit that trampoline and you bounce your way back up into a decent living. How much can cooperatives be, how much can they do in terms of helping us with that sort of trampoline effect for people like Mary who fell through the holes in the social safety net but really needed a trampoline to bounce them back up?
Well, I think there's a number of ways. Co-ops are, what they do, working on co-ops, they really unleash that entrepreneurial spirit, okay? Mm-hmm. So they when you've hit that bottom part of that trampoline, right, the co-op is an opportunity that, for example, we work with a lot of co-ops where you see folks who are pooling their resources and get together. Mm-hmm. Their option for, they're not finding jobs, so their option is to start a business. They don't have the resources personally. They combine with friends and neighbors, people of like minds, mm-hmm. To build this business from scratch, okay? So that's obviously the higher wages that you tend to find, the capital accumulation for the individual. You tend to find those all things that have a cumulative effect around the neighborhood, right? Mm-hmm. The other real way in which we're seeing this is with opportunities like the union co-op, where you have set wages, you create businesses that pay a living wage, to provide benefits. And the real intriguing piece is what, I don't know how familiar we are with the Evergreen Cooperatives here in Cleveland, okay? And that was a project that we've worked on with other folks like the Cleveland Foundation and the Democracy Collaborative. And what they are is a network of small businesses, of cooperatives that partner together. And what they do on an ongoing basis is not only provide good employment, good wages, benefits, and that capital accumulation, but they also set aside, they have, I think, currently four businesses up and running now. And they set aside 10% of each of those businesses' earnings, okay, profits, for the creation of additional businesses. So it becomes like an incubator for additional small businesses that are organized as worker-owned cooperatives that hire, that exist in our inner city communities, that hire from folks who may not have the job opportunities that some other folks may be. So I think there's a lot of ways in which this kind of grassroots from the ground up kind of thing, it's kind of moving with that bottom part of the trampoline. It's moving from the bottom up,
the
right?
The town gown connection, the academy, right, working with workers, movements. I know Cleveland, right, State University and my dear brother Ron Berkman and others have this concern about town gown relations and trying to make sure that, right, some of the pressing problems like poverty and inequality are wrestled with in a serious manner.
You know, exactly, and we, you had mentioned the food issue of the access to food, and mm-hmm, we're working with a lot of co-ops that are creating linkages between underserved communities and the producers who may be, you know, finding it hard to take their produce somewhere, you know, creating those networks so, mm-hmm, you not only help the inner cities, but you help the rural areas too.
We're going to break here in about 30 seconds. Before you go to that break, though, Chris, two things. One, for those in the audience, we're going to take a short break here, and when we come back, we're going to come to your questions and comments. You've been very patient for 2 hours sitting here listening to all this good information. We want to hear what you have to say. So this next segment, our guests will stay with us, but we want to hear from you. Your questions and comments from everyday Americans who have gathered with us here in Cleveland. But right quick, though, Chris, in 10 seconds or 15 seconds, for persons who are listening right now, poor persons who want to be like Mary and bounce back, where's the best place to go to get information about starting a cooperative? How they, is there a source you would recommend?
Give us a call. Yeah. We have a cooperative development center that, okay, that we run in addition to the employee ownership center.
We're
at Kent State.
Yeah, at Kent State. Is there either email or phone number? Yeah.
OEOCKent.org, mm-hmm, or OEOC@kent.edu.
Okay.
They can get a hold of us.
Say it one more time.
Absolutely. OEOC@kent.edu and OEOCKent.org.
Got it. There you go. All right. So please thank them. Please thank Chris and Mary and Carl for being with us. We are in Cleveland. It's day one of the Poverty Tour 2.0. From here, we go to Virginia and Pennsylvania and Florida, but we are delighted to be in the Buckeye State. My mama just walked in the room, y'all. That's my mama, Joyce Smiley. So I'm going to take a break right quick and go give my mama a hug. You are listening to the Poverty Tour 2.0 distributed by Pacifica and Native Voice One.
Yeah, Miss Smiley in the house. Miss Smiley in the house. What a blessing. What a blessing.
We are survivors. We are survivors. We are survivors. And we're moving on. We are courageous. We are courageous. We are courageous. And we're moving on. And we are united. We are.
Welcome back to the Poverty Tour 2.0. Just gave my mama a hug. So my mama, we're in Ohio. I grew up in Indiana. So I grew up just next door and went to school at Indiana University. And we know a little something about poverty. If I really wanted to convince you that poverty is real, my mother could get on the microphone and tell you how she and my father raised 10 kids. My mother and father have six kids, or six boys in my family. And I had an aunt who was murdered years ago, who had four kids, my cousins, who my parents, in their own impoverished state, brought in to live with us. They didn't want those kids to go to foster homes. So my mother and father adopted my four cousins.
Yes, that's love. That's love. That's love right there.
So there were 10 of us. 10 of us in a 3-bedroom, 1-bathroom trailer. In a trailer park. That's how I grew up. So I've been fortunate and blessed. So part of this tour is about bearing witness to the fact that with cooperatives or other opportunities in this country, you can make a better life for yourself. You can build an entire life on hope. All you need is hope. You can build a life on that. It would help if the conditions in the government and corporate America wouldn't be so greedy and our politics wouldn't be so indifferent. It would help. But we want to make sure that we provide some hope to people to let them know. That's why this cooperative conversation, Doc, is so powerful.
Yes, absolutely.
It's an example of workers coming together.
Coming together.
If nobody comes to the cavalry ain't coming. So if nobody comes to rescue you, there is a way that
that's
you can
right.
pool your resources
that's right.
and your ideas and your creativity and start your own entrepreneurial opportunity. And so we're delighted to have had this conversation about co-ops. Okay, so we've got a few minutes here to the top of the hour. We're going to give the rest of this hour. We got one more hour coming up here in Cleveland, but for the rest of this hour, we're going to open up some time. See, I've been in public radio too long. I always want donations all the time. you bring me into WCPN, I'm asking for donations. Thanks to generous listeners like you. We're going to make some time here for some questions and comments from the audience. So if you can keep your question or comment very brief, we'd love to hear it, and it can be whatever you want to share with us. But please give us your name if you feel like it.
Well, I want to thank you, gentlemen, for coming. We appreciate all the work you've done in the past. I'm a children and family therapist, 40 years, 34 of those years in the housing projects in New York City. Hmm. So I've dealt with poverty in ways that people have never seen before. I'm a little troubled that you seem to be equating poverty and unemployment to something that Obama has done or hasn't done. Mm-hmm. I'm a little troubled by that, and it's augmented by the fact that when Obama took office, you were tracking him very closely then. It seemed like there was a sort of a vengeance or something against him from the very beginning, and it's carried through to this day. Mm-hmm. There was a big thing on the Tom Joyner show where you walked off the show in some kind of controversy over Obama. I mean, Obama is a young black man who's done his best as far as I'm concerned. I mean, the GOP was, they rejected everything he tried to do from the word go. Now, I wasn't gonna say that, I said it because this meeting took on such a tirade against Obama.
I got your point.
I ain't finished yet.
Hold on. Yes, you are. Hold on 1 second.
Yeah, okay,
hold on 1 second.
Okay,
you are finished.
Okay.
Because you chose to make that point. We want to respond to it, but I said earlier there's a line of folk behind you. You can't make a bunch of points. So take your seat. We thank you for your comment. We're going to respond to what you did say because we respect your comment.
Absolutely.
We want to respond. We want to give other people a voice. So, Doc, you and I'm sure, will say the same thing in response to his critique of us. I'll let you respond and we'll move on.
Well, first, I just want to salute the work that you've done with the precious children.
Absolutely.
Both in New York as well in Ohio.
Absolutely.
Very much so. But, two, I don't detect a spirit of vengeance in this meeting at all. There's a hatred against poverty. I don't think we've heard any hatred of Barack Obama whatsoever. We've talked about him being better than Romney. We've talked about acknowledging the degree to, I didn't say slightly, I said the bar is low because being better than Romney doesn't take a whole lot of effort. But he deserves people's support, absolutely. But you're not, if you came here for an uncritical celebration of any White House, then that's not what you're gonna get. We're talking about a system that is in place that we're keeping track of. We know Barack Obama didn't create poverty. Have you heard Barack Obama give a major speech on poverty in the last 4 years? He talks about other issues. He hasn't said a mumbling word. Have you heard him give a speech on the prison industrial complex? Have you heard him give a speech on the children that you have ministered to, zeroing in on just their situation? No! Yes, healthcare was significant, but healthcare was for...
That was not a minor issue.
Not a minor at all. We support that. We support that. But he gave us a health care where the private insurance and pharmaceutical companies are still in the driver's seat, too. But brothers, don't misread and mislead folk in terms of vengeance. It's not vengeance at all. We're talking about justice across the board. Justice across the board. Me, you, Obama, his mama, my mama, across the board. That's what we're talking about. I salute the work that you do.
We're glad you came. We appreciate your question and your comment, rather. I'm sorry. Yes, sir.
Hi, hello, Greg Groves from Cleveland, Ohio. One of your panelists made a statement about the fact that we are living our values outside of our culture. And Dr. West, I'd like to direct this question to you. What is the need and where's the energy coming from for cultural action, cultural transformation, cultural reconstruction among those who are impoverished, subjugated, dominated, and so forth? Mm-hmm. Where is that energy coming from? Are we in need of cultural transformation in our communities?
Oh, that's a powerful question.
You could do a seminar on that at Union, brother.
No, but it's very important because I would say spiritual transformation as well as cultural transformation. Because you see, for me, when you're really talking about justice, you're talking about compassion across the board. I don't care what color you are. I don't care what culture, I don't care what sexual orientation you are. You're a human being who deserves a certain kind of treatment. We live in a culture where the fundamental orientation is make as much money as you can and more obsession with the 11th commandment, thou shalt not get caught. Do it any way you can and just try not to get caught. That was not the case 40 years ago when we had a movement around justice. Today is much more about success, success, success. Me, 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 I. And it relates to the first question of my dear brother who's done this wonderful work with the youth. All of this flag waving that's taking place that's linked to militarism and drones dropping bombs on innocent people. Nobody want to say a mumbling word because it's an issue of justice. And you see, I speak as a Christian, so when I look at a flag, it's always under the cross. I don't care what flag it is.
That's right. That's right.
Flag, when it's with justice, I'm with the flag. When it's not with justice, I'm not with the flag.
Right.
Period. Period. But that is an unpopular position in our day, in our moment. So we cut against the grain. But we do it with a smile. And we do it, we hope, with an extension of compassion, even with our disagreeing the folk we disagree with.
Thank you for your question. I appreciate it. Yes, sir.
Hi, my name is David Reese. I'm a teacher at Oberlin High School, and I, too, am one of 10 children.
Okay.
So a lot of love to Mom. So I have 9 brothers and sisters, and my parents also raised foster children, and we house refugees from third world countries growing up.
Lord.
So,
you grew up right here in Cleveland?
So, in Huron.
I grew up in Huron, 50 miles down the road.
But in middle school, you know, folks who are waiting to get their green card to go to Canada were living in my home, and I had friends saying, you know, who are those people living in your house? I don't know. Let's go play.
Yeah.
But that Christian model or being raised as a Catholic, mm-hmm. there's a difference between saying that I'm going to give and then actually giving mm-hmm. until it mm-hmm. hurts. So, mm-hmm. but I just wanted to thank you as one of 10, you know, to make that connection.
I appreciate that.
I teach a class at Oberlin High School that I created called Global Perspectives on the Human Spirit, Science, and Faith. And our main text is the conversations from Krista Tippett's On Being, formerly known as Speaking of Faith. Thank you. Mm-hmm. And I feel like the conversations that we have in our class touch on this issue. And because we can talk about issues of faith and we can talk about issues of science that can help solve many of these problems. And if I think I read somewhere that like 87% of Americans consider themselves some form of a Christian. Mm-hmm. Well, if that's the case, let's take that angle and say, how are we treating the least among us? And Dr. West, you said at the very beginning, let's make poverty the center. And the piece that we just listened to this week was this interview from French geophysicist Xavier Lepichon, and he talks about humanity has evolved because we have always put the most fragile among us at the center of mm-hmm. our community, mm-hmm. and we do that with children. Every time we have a child, and when they scream, we're all paying attention to it. And we have from Iraq thousands of years ago, the skeleton of a 40-year-old man who's being carried by family members 5-10 miles a day. And so that's the difference between humans and animals, or humans and humanity, is that we put the least among us at the center.
Let me ask you a quick question, because I want to get your take on something, since you're talking to these precious young people every day and engaging them in dialogue, and I want to get some folk behind you in line here. But let me, instead of answering your statement, let me ask you a question if I can. What are you hearing from your students, to your point a moment ago, of how it is that in a country that is faith-based, that poverty is allowed to run amok in the way that it is? How do they juxtapose the fact that we are a nation of peoples of faith, and yet we see people going uncared for, unresponded to, unloved, unhoused, unfed? How do these students juxtapose those two things?
Probably a few reasons. One, we'll talk about it through an economic lens, which masks talking about it in a moral lens. So as soon as we talk, well, you know, the unexamined life is not worth living.
That's right.
But the examined life is painful.
That's right.
Right? And so we would rather not talk about the painful issues. Instead, we go from math to English to history, and we're not talking about the moral character or the vacuum that's there. And that's why we have things like the school shootings, because there's this emptiness that's
there. No values curriculum.
Exactly. And we're afraid of a values curriculum because we then link that to religion. Mm-hmm. And I'm very blessed to teach in Oberlin, in a community that will accept a class called Global Perspectives on the Human Spirit, Science, and Faith. But all of these texts that we examine are trying to answer the question, what does it mean to be human, and to live a life of meaning? And kids are hungry for these kinds of discussions.
Let me squeeze in. We thank you for your work. Thank you so much. We'll squeeze in one more quick question here before we go to the break. We got a break in 2 minutes, but for those standing in line, we'll get some more questions in the next hour, but this is the last one we can get in before this break at the top of the hour that I have to take. Yes, ma'am.
Good morning. My name is Diane Merriweather, and we understand that poverty has tentacles, but I would like you to address poverty. Not poverty, but crime. Mm-hmm. I, myself, my daughter and I were coming from the library on a Saturday and was robbed at gunpoint. Why does nobody talk about the tentacles that poverty plays when it comes to crime? It's educated people, degree people in my neighborhood that are scared to go out a certain time because of the crime. And that goes back to with George Frazier was saying about a broken down school system. That these, a lot of black people feel like, a lot of young people feel like they have no hope. And they're going to eat whether they wait for me to come home at the 40-hour week and rob me.
Doc, as you well know, in our book, The Rich and the Rest of Us, we talk about the link between poverty and crime. It's clearly.
No, indeed. I'm sorry to hear about your situation. I'm glad you're still here.
Standing
with dignity,
thank
strong
you,
as ever. Yeah, absolutely. But one is, it's the problem of weak family, feeble community, owing to high levels of unemployment, guns flowing, drugs flowing, and the only response is police and prisons. No serious talk about jobs, education, investment in the community so that there's alternatives for these young folk. And that's very important. But I think anytime you think of criminality, criminality, as a Christian, I always look for criminality in high places first. You see, the sixth chapter of Ephesians means something.
Yeah.
The wickedness in high places, Wall Street and other places. And young people look around and see crime and people getting away with it, and they think they can get away with it, and then they attack folk who are weak and vulnerable.
I got to get away and break for this hour. Thank you very much for all your questions. We got one more hour from Cleveland with Jill Stein from the Green Party, Pacifica and Native Voice One. From Cleveland, Ohio's Ideastream Westfield Insurance Studio Theater at the Idea Center, I'm Tavis Smiley.
And I'm Cornel West, and this is the Poverty Tour 2.0.
In this hour, Doc, we'll hear highlights from the U.S. Census announcement just minutes ago, and then we'll be joined by Congressman Dennis Kucinich to talk about priorities, specifically Congress prioritizing funding for the military versus funding for the poor.
Plus, we'll catch up with our friends at the Miller Avenue United Church of Christ in Akron, Ohio. We spoke with them last year. Remember the dialogue? Our dear brother Pastor Tom is here, along with some of the struggling veterans.
Plus, we'll close out the first stop on the Poverty Tour 2.0 with Green Party presidential candidate Dr. Jill Stein will join us in person to talk about her Green New Deal.
That's all just ahead in the final hour.
Thank you.
Tour 2.0.
While Doc and I are having a live conversation with our national media partner, HuffPost Live, we're going to play a few highlights from the Census Bureau's audio news conference, which ended literally moments ago. You'll hear David Johnson, chief of the Bureau's Social, Economic, and Housing Statistics Division. Take a listen.
This slide shows that the number of people in poverty at 46.2 million in 2011 and the poverty rate at 15%. In 2011, a family with two adults and two children was categorized as in poverty if their total income was less than $22,811. And after three consecutive years of increases, neither the poverty rate nor the number of people in poverty were statistically different from the 2010 estimates. Here we demonstrate the disparities in poverty across racial and ethnic groups. Hispanics were the only group to show a decline in their poverty rates from 26.5% in 2010 to 25.3% in 2011. The 2011 poverty rates were 9.8% for non-Hispanic whites, 27.6% for blacks, and 12.3% for Asians. Poverty rates for blacks and Hispanics were more than double the poverty rate for non-Hispanic whites. And the poverty rate in 2011 for children under age 18 was 21.9%. And the poverty rate for people aged 18 to 64 was 13.7%, while the rate for people aged 65 and older was only 8.7%. None of the rates for these age groups were statistically different from their 2010 estimates. And while the poverty rate for all people aged 65 and older was 8.7%, there were large differences by gender. And the poverty rate for women aged 65 and older was 10.7%, compared to only 6.2% for men. This slide shows the change in the number of people in poverty and the number of full-time year-round workers for the three groups for whom there was a decline in both the number of people in poverty and the poverty rate between 2010 and 2011. These are people living in the South, people living inside metropolitan statistical areas but outside principal cities or suburbs, and non-citizens. For instance, the number of people living in the South in poverty decreased by 750,000, while the number of full-time year-round workers in the South increased by 1.2 million. These increases in full-time year-round employment may have contributed to the fall in the number of persons in poverty and the poverty rates for these groups. The next chart presents the distribution from 1967 to 2011 of all people within five ranges of income to poverty ratios. One can see the diminishing share of people in two of the middle groups of the distribution, the blue and orange groups, again implying an increase in income inequality. Since 1967, the percentage of people with income between 200 and 399% of their poverty threshold has decreased from 40.6% to 30.5%. And the share of population with income between 100 and 199% of their threshold was also down from 26.9% to 19.4%. And over the same period, the shares of the population in the top and the bottom groups increased. The income and poverty estimates in this report are based solely on money income before taxes and used the poverty thresholds developed more than 40 years ago. In 2009, the Office of Management and Budget's chief statistician formed an interagency technical working group. This group provided the Census Bureau and the Bureau of Labor Statistics a set of observations to serve as a roadmap in the development of a new supplemental poverty measure. The new measure will not replace the official poverty measure and will not be used to determine eligibility for government programs. The first SPM poverty estimates were released last November, and the new SPM estimates for 2011 will be released on Tuesday, November 13th. This slide compares the SPM poverty estimates for 2010, last year, with the official poverty estimates from last year for all people and by age group. The SPM poverty rate for the entire population was 16%, 8/10 of a percentage point higher than the official rate. And looking at the specific age categories, the SPM poverty rate was lower than the official rate for children, but higher than the official rate for those aged 65 and older. And while we don't have SPM estimates for 2011, we can look at the sensitivity of the poverty estimates to changes in the income measure. This table shows the incremental impact on a number of people in poverty of the addition or subtraction of a single resource component. Money income, which we use to calculate the official rates, includes all cash income, such as earnings, Social Security, unemployment compensation, cash public assistance, interest, and dividends, but excludes non-cash government transfers and tax credits. So we can find out if the value of supplemental nutritional assistance program, or food stamps, were added to money income, then 3.9 million fewer people would be classified as in poverty. Alternatively, if the estimates of federal earned income tax credit were added to money income, then 3 million fewer children would be classified as in poverty. If the unemployment insurance benefits, which are included in money income, were not included, the number of adults aged 18 to 64 classified as in poverty in 2011 would have increased by 16 million. Finally, one can examine the effectiveness of the Social Security program in reducing the number of people aged 65 and older in poverty. In 2011, the number of people aged 65 and over in poverty would be higher by about 14.5 million if Social Security payments were excluded from money income, more than quintupling the number of people aged 65 and over in poverty. Our main finding is that health insurance coverage increased between 2010 and 2011. This chart presents the uninsured rate from 1987 to 2011. The percentage of people without health insurance in 2011 decreased to 15.7%. The percentage of children without health insurance in 2011, 9.4%, was not statistically different from 2010. In 1987, the uninsured rate for both all people and children was 12.9%. In 1999, the gap between all people and children was 1.6 percentage points, and by 2011, the gap grew to 6.3 percentage points. In 2011, the percentage of people covered by private health insurance was not statistically different from 2010. And this is the first time in the last 10 years that the rate of private insurance coverage has not decreased. The percentage of people covered by government health insurance programs, which includes Medicaid, Medicare, the Children's Health Insurance Program, and military coverage, increased for the fifth consecutive year to 32.2% in 2011. Hence, the increase in public coverage and no statistical change in private coverage may account for the increase in overall coverage. This chart focuses on uninsured people by race and ethnicity. Compared with 2010, the uninsured rate decreased for non-Hispanic whites, blacks, and Asians in 2011. The uninsured rate for Hispanics in 2011 was not statistically different from the rate in 2010. And comparing 1999 and 2011, the uninsured rate went up for non-Hispanic whites from 9 to 11.1%, while it decreased for Hispanics from 31.9% to 30.1%. And blacks and Asians did not have a statistical difference when comparing 1999 and 2011. Let's look more closely at the new health insurance estimates. This chart shows the percentage point change in uninsured rates by age. We chose these particular age groups as they are of special interest because of recent changes in the law. Children under the age of 19 are eligible for Medicaid and CHIP, and individuals aged 19 to 25 may now be a dependent on a parent's health plan. The uninsured rate of children under age 19 was not statistically different from the year before. Those aged 26 to 34 and 45 to 64 also had no significant difference in their uninsured rates between 2010 and 2011. However, people aged 19 to 25 had a decrease in the uninsured rate of 2.2 percentage points. Two other age groups also saw a decrease in their uninsured rate: people aged 35 to 44 and those aged 65 and over. Next, we take a look at the relationship of household income and being uninsured. 25.4% of people living in households with income below $25,000 were uninsured, whereas 7.8% of people living in households with income above $75,000 were uninsured. The 2011 uninsured rate for people in households with income less than $25,000 experienced a decrease in the uninsured rate, while the other income groups did not have a statistical difference from 2010. And when we compare 1999 with 2011, all income groups have higher uninsured rates. This chart shows the age distribution of the total population compared to the uninsured. People aged 18 to 44 years comprise 36.2% of the total population, but comprise 56.7% of the uninsured population. And if we were to expand the age groups to those 18 to 64, we'd see that they make up 62.5% of the total population, but compose 84.2% of the uninsured population. This slide further examines 18 to 64-year-old population by the distribution of work status. Among the total population of 18 to 64-year-olds, over 50% work full-time year-round, while 24.2% worked less than full-time, and 25.4% did not work. However, among the uninsured for 18 to 64-year-olds, only 32% did not work, and nearly two-thirds of the uninsured worked at least 1 week during the year. And of these, over half work full-time year-round. That concludes my part of the presentation. The report, this presentation, and many more tables are available on our website.
That's David Johnson, Chief of the Census Bureau's Social, Economic, and Housing Statistics Division. Just a few minutes ago, as you heard there, he presented their latest findings on poverty in America.
Still to come, our dear brother Congressman Dennis Kucinich will join us along with our friends from Akron, Pastor Tom from Miller Avenue United Church of Christ, along with some of the struggling military vets we met on the first poverty tour last year. We'll see, Doc, how they're surviving in this economy.
Indeed, and later this hour, our dear sister Jill Stein, Green Party candidate for president, joins us. Stay with us.
Oh, the dream has come at last, and you've left those hells behind, where you have lived for all this time. It was a child who went away, a man returns today. And welcome back. None of us can really know how hard you've suffered, but brother, in my way, I've died a little every day with the pain of how you've had to live.
Welcome back to the Poverty Tour 2.0. We are live in Cleveland at the Ideastream Westfield Insurance Studio Theater at the Idea Center. Today is day one of our Poverty Tour 2.0, in case you're just tuning in, case you're just joining us here live. We are going to four battleground states, starting, of course, in the Buckeye State of Ohio, and then headed to Virginia, then the Keystone State of Pennsylvania, and then down to Florida. Four battleground states in this tour, trying to get the issue of poverty pushed up higher on the American agenda. In a moment, we'll be joined by your Congressman Dennis Kucinich from Capitol Hill. We'll be joined by him in this conversation. And our friend Pastor Tom from the Miller Avenue United Church of Christ, our friend we met a year or so ago when we took our poverty tour, going to 9 states, 18 cities, turned that into a week-long special on PBS. We filmed that tour, so we're going to talk to Pastor Tom and the Congressman in just a moment. But Doc, let's just top line these census numbers. So it's official now. The numbers are out today, and there really has been no real change in poverty in this country. It would have been nice, obviously, if we'd seen poverty go down. But as I've been saying, with the job numbers from last week and the poverty numbers today, it's pretty clear that poverty is the new American norm.
Well, it's still intolerable, 15.0%. and 1.5% decline in income. But the important thing is to keep the stress on the fight back. And what brings us together in the fight back? Because, I mean, we knew it would go, the levels would be intolerable. And Brother Pastor Tom and others have been fighting there in Akron with our veterans, and you've got people of all colors, all faiths in your church, in the neighborhood as part of the fight back. So we don't want to get in any way discouraged by these levels. We don't want to get in any way discouraged by even our disagreements on other issues or even candidates. Let's keep the focus on the precious poor folk catching hell, right, and tell the truth about it and come together and fight.
And we will continue to do that just now, in fact, with Congressman Dennis Kucinich. Congressman, are you there?
I am speaking to you from Washington, D.C., where I'm expected to be going to the floor of the House in a little bit to debate on a bill that's coming up. So I'm glad to be with you, and hello, Cleveland. Miss you.
Please welcome your Congressman, Dennis Kucinich.
Brother Dennis.
Congressman, let me start with you, because I know you've got to run for a vote. Pastor Tom, thankfully, is here with us in the studio, so we can ask him to sit for just a second and just spend three or four quick minutes with you, I guess, and get your thoughts on a few things and let you get on to that House vote. We talked earlier to your colleague, Marcy Kaptur, the longest-serving woman, of course, in the House. But give me your sense of why it is that the Democrats have not pushed harder, why the president hasn't pushed harder, why Republicans are obstructionist when it comes to raising the minimum wage to a living wage in this country. Why won't Congress take that up?
Well, I think that the economic policies driving this country come from Wall Street. They don't come from Washington. And you have a Fed that has helped banks print money out of nothing and that engages in something called quantitative easing, where the Fed creates money out of nothing. They give it to banks. Banks park it at the Fed. They don't invest in our community. They don't give the money to businesses so they can stay open or create jobs. At the same time, the policies here in Washington have not helped people who were losing their homes. They didn't want to write down mortgages to help people stay in their homes. We lost a chance 2 years ago for a $600 billion highway bill that would have kept millions at work and would have helped rebuild our infrastructure. And the Fed has a policy right now that really establishes 6% as that level of unemployment that's acceptable for the proper functioning of the economy. Our economics here in Washington are all wrong. We need to have a full employment economy back to the days of Humphrey Hawkins, where every able-bodied American who wants to work can have a job to support his or her family. We need jobs for all, and housing for all, and education for all, retirement security for all, not-for-profit health care for all, and we need peace. And the other connection is this. I've got fellow Democrats crying crocodile tears for the poor, and they support the military budget expansion. They support wars. Mm. Well, they say they're for peace. Let's get real.
I just simply say ditto to that, Brother Dennis. Absolutely.
Congressman, how would you describe that? I appreciate your candor in terms of suggesting that we need to get real. But how difficult is it for members of Congress to try to speak that truth? I mean, obviously the country's mm-hmm. in denial. But I want to just, again, go a little deeper with your point about members of Congress who do things and say something else, or say one thing and do something else. How do you, you're not that way, obviously, but how do you explain that? These are your colleagues, after all, many of them Democrats.
Look, there's a tendency to support the status quo once you get here. You're here, you go along. I didn't come here to go along. I came here to tell the truth. The truth is, we went to war against a nation, Iraq, that didn't attack us, in a war that's going to cost $3 to $5 trillion, add to the national debt, and diminish our ability to meet priorities here at home to address people's practical aspiration for jobs, healthcare, education, housing, retirement security. So what's happening is there's a direct connection between the wars and increased military spending and the rise of poverty in the United States. Iraq didn't have weapons of mass destruction, but poverty is a weapon of mass destruction, joblessness is a weapon of mass destruction, homelessness is a weapon of mass destruction, and we have to start taking care and disabling these weapons here at home. We're not doing it. It's like we're roaming the world looking for dragons to slay, and we can't even take care of things in our own cities. And frankly, I'm not buying it from either party.
Mm. So what then did you make of your party's convention days ago and mentioning, of course, poverty here and there, although we noted earlier in this program that the New York Times has done the research on this. The Democrats, you might find it interesting, Congressman, the Democrats mentioned the word poor or poverty 3 times for every 25,000 words. The Republicans, are you ready for this, mentioned it 5 times for every 25,000 words. So in terms of just at least giving lip service to the issue, the Republicans outdid the Democrats. So what does a guy like you, who's really, really progressive and wants to put these issues front and center, but obviously that is a small caucus on the Capitol or in the Capitol. So what did you make of the recent Democratic convention where this issue is concerned?
I was at the convention, and it's too bad that we didn't talk about the fact that there are about 46 million Americans at or below the poverty line. It's too bad we didn't talk about the fact that there are 10 million Americans out of work, and there are Americans that have stopped looking for work because they can't find any work, that there are millions of people who have lost their homes. And Cleveland was the epicenter of the subprime meltdown when National City Bank and others went and took no-doc and low-doc loans in the areas where people were desperate for homes and basically created a swindle that set the stage for the collapse of neighborhoods. Now, I wish we'd have talked about that because it would have been more getting real about what's happening in America and would have made the case for the administration staying in. Look, I'm supporting Barack Obama, so in case anybody's wondering. But that doesn't mean that I've bought hook, line, and sinker his economics or his foreign policy. We don't have, you know, if we are going to create the vision of a new society here where we can put people back to work, where we can restore our neighborhoods, then we've got to start changing our priorities. And we've got to stop spending money all over the world, taking care of things everywhere except here, back here at home. And that's something that I feel very strongly about. And we have to stop monetary policies that essentially are enabling the rich to get richer and the poor to get poorer. I didn't come to Washington to help those who are already doing very well to be in an even better position while people in my neighborhood are struggling to survive.
I know you're rushing back to the floor. One last question before we let you go. We, of course, sit here in your hometown of Cleveland. On a couple of occasions, if I recall correctly, this city has been at the top of the list, if not number one, but certainly near the top of the list for being the poorest city in America. And we started this tour here in Ohio and in Cleveland for the obvious reasons. But what's your sense of how these factors, these issues rather, of poverty and income inequality and economic injustice, what's your sense of how these issues are going to play or factor into whoever ultimately will win the Buckeye State? Because as Ohio goes, so goes the nation.
Well, that's true. Look, we've got to get people back to work. We could put millions of people to work rebuilding our infrastructure. And the government can choose to do that if it wants to. I mean, the Federal Reserve took the power of the government away in 1913 to be able to create the resources that are necessary to be able to rebuild America. We need to reclaim that power. We need to put millions of people back to work, rebuilding our roads, our bridges, our water systems, our sewer systems. Our manufacturing economy took a hit with trade deals. NAFTA was a disaster for Ohio and for the Cleveland area, and all these other trade agreements, including China trade, have been a nightmare. We've got between a $500 and $600 billion trade deficit. A large portion of it was China. What's China about? Low wages, no workers' rights, no human rights, no environmental quality principles. We've got to redirect the compass of the American workforce so that we can protect workers' rights, so that the right to organize, the right to collective bargaining, the right to strike, the right to decent wages and benefits, the right to a safe workplace, the right to a secure retirement is in every trade agreement we have. They're not there now. We need to make sure we have protections against child labor, slave labor, prison labor. Those are not in our trade agreements. We need to make sure that we protect the environment. Lake Erie, we know what a precious resource that is. We don't want that lost through a dumbing down of environmental laws all over the world. Look, America can still make a comeback, but we can't do it Wall Street calling the shots, frankly. We need Main Street sentiments, Main Street logic, and we need to go into the neighborhoods of our city. We need to give young people a chance who are waiting on the corners saying, hey, what are you going to do? Can you help me get a job? Mm-hmm. I mean, this ought to be a passion in America mm-hmm. to put America back to work instead of just coasting into the next term.
One last quick question, Brother Dennison, namely this, that even when we acknowledge that Barack Obama is much better than Mitt Romney, why is your party on such intimate terms with the oligarchs on Wall Street too?
Well, would you repeat that question again? Because I didn't hear the end of it.
I said, why is the dominant figures in your party on intimate terms with the oligarchs on Wall Street, even when we conclude with you that Barack Obama is much better than Mitt Romney when it comes to poor people?
It's about money. I mean, that's where the campaign funds come from. I mean, the hedge funds backed President Obama's rise as a candidate. I know, I was in that race.
How are we going to get to hitting poverty head on if the money is controlled?
Well, that's the
problem.
I mean, listen,
you got your voice and some others, but
you've got the House of Plenty on the ascendant right now. and the House of have-nots are scrambling people in that House. So,
but maybe we just got to hit the streets and go to jail, bro.
The Democratic Party, well, you know what? There needs to be a new civil rights movement, which includes advocates for jobs.
Absolutely. I
mean, absolutely. Well, it's for jobs, for education, for housing, for not-for-profit health care, for peace, for retirement security. We need people back out on the streets again. Because right now, you know, if you look at the Washington is an auction right now where policies go to the highest bidder. The influence of these interest groups right now is so extraordinary. We're going to have an election that'll probably cost about $4 billion. And yet the concerns, the practical concerns that people have are being ignored. I'm glad you're doing this poverty tour. It helps to reawaken people, but we also need to reimagine what America can be.
That's right. That's
you know,
right.
We don't have to have a country that's going to hell in a handbasket, but we do have to have a country where we pay attention to people's needs here and stop spending money all over the world fomenting wars. Yeah. We've got to stop it. We're not any safer for doing that.
Congressman,
just one more thing.
Sure.
You know, we have this fiscal budget right now for the next year, $653 billion for the military. And when we're spending on housing and education, $134 billion of discretionary spending. Now, you look at what, that's a statement of values. Yeah. What are we afraid of? We have more, we spend more money on arms than the rest of the world combined. What are we afraid of? I'll tell you what I'm afraid of. I'm afraid of people who don't have a job, who are hopeless. I'm concerned about people who don't have a house or who are on the way out the door with their house. I'm concerned about people who are finding their retirement money starting to evaporate. I'm concerned about our schools not having the resource they need, or teachers who don't have the rights that they should have to when they're in the classroom. You know, there's a whole thing happening in America that I'm not happy about, and it started before 9/11. It's intensified by 9/11, and now we've got a country where poverty keeps growing and hopelessness is on the rise. We've got to get America back to work. That's what I've been talking about here for 16 years and looking for programs. I've got a bill, H.R. 2990, the National Emergency Employment Defense Act, which changes our monetary policies, enable America to go back to work, rebuilding America. There's nothing wrong with America that jobs for all won't solve.
Congressman, you're a rare breed in Washington. Thank you for joining us. We appreciate it.
Appreciate you, though, brother.
Stay strong.
Thank you.
Stay strong.
Thanks, Cleveland.
Dennis.
Love you, Cleveland. Thank you.
Pleased to be joined by Pastor Tom of the Miller Avenue United Church of Christ. We got a break in just about 2 minutes here, but I'm going to ask you to stick around for a second. But I wanted just to ask you to give us an update on how our friends are doing on our poverty tour last year. Pastor Tom does some remarkable work with military vets, these veterans who can't find work and have been unemployed for years. He feeds them and helps take care of them and provides all kinds of services for these. We're talking about military veterans here in the state of Ohio. And he is a freedom fighter, and he's our hero and one of our leaders on this issue. So please welcome Pastor Tom to this program. I'm going to come back to you in just a second, but in a quick minute, give me an update on how these vets are doing that we met a year ago.
Well, one of them is here with us today. Charles is here, Sir Charles. And
where's Charles at? Hey, Charles, how are you, man? Good to see you again. Yeah.
And I think that I can say, and not speaking for Charles, but that his lot has improved.
That's good news.
He has relocated out of the immediate neighborhood in which the church is located to an apartment about 3 miles north. He says that, he told me on the way up here that it feels comfortable for him, but he still knows what's going on in the city. And so he and I had a very interesting conversation about that. I want to also give you a report on your friend, Goldie.
That's what I want to hear about. Yeah. I'm about to ask you about Goldie. How's Brother Goldie doing?
Well, Goldie spent 3 months of this year at Wade Park, which is a veterans hospital here in Cleveland. And he said he received excellent, excellent treatment here. I almost sensed a wistfulness in his voice as he reported on the conditions here. He received treatment for his cancer. It's not complete yet. He'll be coming back up here at the end of this month. He was looking forward to coming up and agreed that he would yesterday afternoon, and then not a half hour later had to come up and tell me he couldn't do it. So we sat out on the front porch of the church and caught up a little more on what was going on in his life.
Are any of those persons, those unemployed vets, persons who have put their lives on the line for our freedoms, persons who were injured in defending this nation, who could not find work a year ago. Any good news about jobs from amongst the folk in that room that we met?
I can't say that any of them that I know of have full employment. Mm-hmm. You remember the one young woman who joined us?
I was about to ask about her, yeah.
Hillary.
She had her husband, yeah.
Yes, Hillary. Hillary has employment in a kind of a circuitous fashion and serving within her own family. She has a special needs daughter. And through some government programs, they're able to allow some funding to help support the family as she helps to support her daughter. Mm. And so they found a way to make a way, if you will, mm-hmm. not unlike Goldie in his testimony about helping to serve those others who were even less fortunate than he was
Absolutely.
To stay in his own home.
Sandra Ellington, same sentiment, mm-hmm. same orientation.
That's why we love Goldie. Goldie was, you know, unemployed military vet himself and had other vets staying with him.
Staying with him,
a house full of vets all unemployed trying to make it together. It's a powerful story. Please tell them all. We wish we had more time. Please tell them all we said hello.
You know I will.
That we send our love, mm-hmm. and we love you, and we're delighted you came to see us today.
Thank you, Pastor Tom
of the Miller United Church of Christ. We're in Cleveland. This is the Poverty Tour 2.0. We're back in just a moment with a conversation with the Green Party's candidate for president, Dr. Jill Stein. Stay with us. This is being brought to you by Pacifica and Native Voice One.
I said, hey, missy, you're the one. I said, hey, missy, you're the one. Now, when I was a boy, just starting out, you know, I really wasn't sure. And the girls all smiled as they walked on by. It was a perfume, hazy blur. And I looked in the north, I looked in the south, I looked in the east and the west. I knew all along what I was looking for. And missy, you're the best. I said, hey, missy, you're the one. I said, hey, missy, you're the one.
Welcome back to Cleveland. Let's hear it for Dr. Jill Stein walking in the room now. A little bit of break there, trying to get her out of the hallway into the room, but she's here now. We're going to come to her in just a second. Let me tell you how these last 20 minutes are going to go. We're going to spend most of this time in conversation with the Green Party's candidate. We're going to be with Ralph Nader. Ralph Nader will be with us tomorrow. We are in Alexandria, Virginia tomorrow, day two of this poverty tour. We'll be joined by Ralph Nader and Peter Edelman and a number of other great Americans in Virginia tomorrow on day two. But when you talk about the Green Party, you have to raise the name of our dear friend Ralph Nader, who again we'll see tomorrow. So if you're in the Alexandria area, go to our website, smileyandwest.com, and come see us tomorrow for day two of this poverty tour. I want to do this now. I've learned 20 years of doing this on the radio. What you don't want to do is get into a great conversation with a presidential candidate because they tend to have things to say. And then at the end, run out of time and not get your thank yous in. And we would not be here today, wouldn't be possible to have done this without a lot of wonderful people. So let me just do this right quick. Special thanks again to our media partners here at 90.3 WCPN, Ideastream for this fantastic space, particularly Dave Kanzig, Ella Fong, Jeff Carlton, everybody else who made it happen. Please thank all of them at WCPN for having us here. We thank our community partners, the City Club of Cleveland, Kent State University, the Ohio Employee Ownership Center. Please thank our community partners as well. Please thank them. And one big last round of applause to our first ever house band. Please thank Jeff Moyer and Kevin Richards and Joe Hunter and Brother Ed and Brother Harris. We thank you all. I know y'all can do better. Give them some more love. I know you can do better than that. They played today for 3 hours.
Yeah.
In between these breaks and moving people in and moving people out, and everything sounded beautiful. So thank you again to the band for being here. We're going to talk to Dr. Jill here in just a second. And then at the end of this program, for the last couple of minutes, we're going to give the audience, as should be the case, give the audience the last word. There are a number of folks standing in line today that we didn't get a chance to talk to, but at the very end of this conversation with her, we're going to come to you. It's going to be rapid fire, so whatever your quick question, and they've already been identified, so your quick question or a quick comment will be offered to the national audience. Doc and I won't have a chance to respond to it on the air, but the good news is we got a few more days of doing this, so we'll jot some of these questions down and try to answer them tomorrow and the next day as we continue this poverty to a 2.0 across the country. Is that all right with everybody? So we're going to give the American people the last word in this conversation. Jill Stein, good to see you. Thank you for coming on.
Thank you so much. It's really an honor to be here.
Tell me why you're running.
For all the reasons that you've been listening to for the last couple of hours. You know, we have this incredible crisis. People are losing jobs, decent wages, their homes by the millions, affordable health care, the costs are skyrocketing, affordable higher education. We have millions of students and recent graduates who are basically indentured servants, and there's no way out. Our civil liberties are under attack, and our climate is in meltdown. And the wealthy few are richer than ever, and the political establishment that got us here is not only not fixing it, they're actually making it worse by imposing austerity on the everyday people of America while they continue to squander trillions of dollars on wars, Wall Street bailouts, and tax breaks for the wealthy. In short, the American people are at the breaking point, and we need to turn it into a tipping point and take back our democracy and the future we deserve.
Let's get this out of the way right quick.
No, we should acknowledge it.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
You say
what? I want to do one quick follow-up. I'm sorry, Doug. I just want to get this out of the way right quick so we can get on to the rest of the conversation. So for those persons who are listening right now, because you've been asked this question 1,000 times, I want to just hear your answer and get it out of the way. Mm-hmm. For those who are listening right now who think that a vote for the Green Party is a wasted vote, you know Ralph Nader got subjected to this. Other third-party candidates have been subjected to it, that when you decide you're going to run in a very, very close race like the one we have here in Ohio and everywhere else, in a race this close, there are people who think that voting for you, even if you're right, would be a wasted vote because it might allow one or the other guy to get in. How do you respond to that allegation? Sorry, Dr. West.
Yeah, and thanks for raising it. I think it's really important to address that because I think we all agree that we are at the breaking point. We all agree that we can fix it. We have the resources to fix it. We have the solutions. We know how. And we actually have the public support. By large majorities, the public actually supports all the things that we've been hearing about today, the things that need to be done, creating jobs, raising the wages, providing health care and education and housing as a human right and retirement security. We have the know-how and the ability to do it. Why don't we get there? You know, the bottom line is we are told to be very afraid of standing up for ourselves. And people point to Bush, Nader, Gore in 2000 and say all these terrible things happened, which they did. But it's, you know, that was then, this is now. It's important to remember that terrible things continue to happen even under a Democratic president when there were two houses of Congress that were Democratic. And when you actually look at two things, so one is look at what actually went on in the Nader-Bush-Gore race. The exit polls actually show that Nader drew voters, this was in Florida, equally from Democrats and Republicans, but they were a small piece of his vote. What he really was supported by was independent voters who had previously voted independently and were not going to vote either Democratic or Republican, no matter what. So it's really a public relations campaign to say that Nader threw the election. It was the Supreme Court that stole the election from the American people. And this is a myth that's been drummed into us for 10 years so that we are afraid of standing up for ourselves. But when you look at where this politics of fear has gotten us, because for at least 10 years, people have really been scared into silence. So what we've learned is that silence is not an effective political strategy. Mm-hmm. And number two, that the politics of fear has actually delivered everything that we were afraid of. All those reasons we were told to be quiet and not stand up because we might have a president who would expand the war, like the Obama White House has massively expanded the war. And people may remember, if you caught it, because it wasn't really emphasized, but the reason we withdrew from Iraq was not because of what the president did. It was because it was George Bush's date of withdrawal, where the immunity for our troops ended on that day. So he was forced to withdraw, had done his darndest to try to extend that date and keep our troops there longer. Meanwhile, he surged the troops into Afghanistan, expanded the drone wars into Pakistan. On day three, actually, of his administration, he intensified the bombing on Pakistan. Where were the Republicans that were supposed to be responsible for this? They were nowhere to be found. This was the president's own doing that has intensified the war effort. Or look at the Wall Street bailouts. $800 billion under George Bush became $4.5 trillion of money dispersed under this Democratic administration. And on top of that $4.5 trillion, another $16 trillion in basically zero interest free loans, which also cost us. So the Wall Street bailouts got bigger. The free trade agreements that offshore our jobs and undermine wages here at home, those got bigger. They are continuing to get bigger as the Obama White House negotiates this Trans-Pacific Partnership, the latest free trade agreement. You know, the attack on our civil liberties, the list goes on. The immigrant racial profiling and deportations, the war on drugs, which is, you know, the fastest growing expenditure. This school to prison pipeline is the second fastest growing expenditure of our state governments. It's an absolute outrage. It's second after healthcare expenses. So the point is, the politics of fear, the politics of fear brought us everything we were afraid of, because if our voices aren't in it and fighting, and as Frederick Douglass said, power concedes nothing without a demand. It never did and it never will. We need to bring that demand into the voting booth and replace the politics of fear with the politics of courage. We are the ones we've been waiting for.
We should let our audience know that we invited all of the presidential candidates. It's very important, very important. And our dear sister was the only one to respond in this regard. But who knows? Folk may show up in Virginia and other places where we're going. But let me ask a very personal question, because you know the great respect and love I have for you. We were in college together, graduated the same year, and you're still a freedom fighter, just as I attempted to be. But it's just so difficult when you think of the life and death issues of this corrupt political system that's shaped by big money and oligarchs and plutocrats, that when you look at the differences between Barack Obama and Mitt Romney, both of them tied to the corrupt system. Both of them not talking about poverty. Both of them tied to the middle industrial complex and so forth. There are some differences that make a difference in the life and death of actual people who we love and precious citizens we want to defend. And so I say to myself, and Tavis and I wrestle with this all the time, I say, you know, the Green Party, good God, you all represent so much of what I actually attempt to live. And yet when I look at the limited options and all this corruption, and I think of Letitia and Jamal and Juanita and other folk, and if I see Romney taking over, I see reactionary crypto-fascist possibilities. If I see Barack taking still in place, he's part of the system, he's head of the system, I bring critique to bear, but he is better on these issues. So I say, I want to be with Jill so bad, but I still don't want those lives and to be overlooked, the deaths to increase, because there's a sense in which one or two of those folk want to be president in November, as much as I wish you were going to be president. What do you say to a brother like me?
I vote for her.
I vote for her. You think I should? Oh, I see. I see. So you think the brother's right? Should I vote for you?
Well, yeah.
I already I already disagree with him on other things, so you're probably wrong again. He's probably wrong again.
Great.
Yeah, and I would have to say there are lots of brothers and sisters in the leadership of the Green Party, you know, who are leading us where we need to go, who are saying that, you know, that this is a dead end. And also pointing to the fact that what you got here are two really different narratives. One is the sort of celebration of selfishness on the part of the lunatic Republicans, you know, and then you have kind of a warm and fuzzy fairy tale on the part of the Democrats. But when you actually look at the facts on the ground, What we got from Barack Obama, unfortunately, has been as bad and in many ways worse than what we got from George Bush in terms of the undermining of our wages, the offshoring of our jobs, the expansion of this war, which is draining $1 trillion of our precious, scarce resources every year into this massive military-industrial security complex. You know, talk about the crypto-fascist state, you know. Unfortunately, under Obama, all of those scary things that George Bush began to do, they all got written into law under Barack Obama and, in fact, expanded to where we now have, you know, these policies that criminalize protest, that can make you a felon and throw you into jail simply for being at the wrong place at the wrong time. You didn't even know that it was declared a zone of special national security. You can go to jail for 10 years. So, you know, they're scaring the living daylights out of us about exercising our First Amendment rights. We've seen, you know, this indefinite detention thing written into law, even of U.S. citizens, and the president now has the right to assassinate anyone, even U.S. citizens, and he's exerted that right to assassinate U.S. citizens and even their children who are minors. So, you know, I just want to make a point that this politics of fear has actually delivered everything we were afraid of, and it's only the politics of courage. Throughout our history, we've had to stand up. When times are bad, we, you know, all the more reason to stand up, because right now we are headed to the bottom of the ocean on two ships, and you can argue around the margins one might be sinking more quickly than the other, but they're both sinking pretty darn fast.
To your point now, we've only got a couple minutes left with you, and to your point now about sinking fast or faster, depending on what ship you're on, what say you to the American people about this notion that many of us do have, that our two-party system is fundamentally broken, that there ought to be a third way, there ought to be a third choice, since we're so disappointed in both of the two major parties for different reasons. You've laid that out brilliantly today for those who subscribe to that philosophy. But I sense, and the polling even suggests, that more Americans are getting more and more turned off to this, you know, corrupt two-party system, and yet the third-party way can't ever seem to really get off the ground. Why is that?
Well, you know, I think we're in a very different moment right now. We're really at an historical tipping point, you know, and we see this spirit of democracy and justice is just rising up all around us, from, you know, from the democracy revolutions in the Middle East to the eviction blockades all over this country, the student protests, the Occupy movement, you name it, by substantial majorities. People are actually standing up to say, these are the solutions. We support them in large numbers. It's never been like that before.
But, but my point is the standing up and the courage that you're talking about can take the form of social movements that put pressure on the system as a whole. Because I do have a suspicion of political parties across the board, including the Green Party.
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm a little suspicious of political parties, no matter who they are. In terms of action on the street, social motions in the legacy of Martin King and others, that does make a difference. What case can you make that, for those of us concerned with courage and vision, is really more social movement, streets and jails, putting pressure on the system as a whole, rather than jumping forth with a party?
It's unfair, but 30 seconds.
I agree. The real engine here is the social movement. And one of the tools of that social movement is its political voice. As Frederick Douglass says, you got to make that demand. And in fact, how did we get the advances of the labor movement, the 40-hour work week, safe workplaces, and so on? We had small parties that pushed that demand. Why did FDR actually implement the New Deal and Social Security and all that? He was threatened by those third parties, by the socialists, by the labor, by the progressive parties. And in fact, when the AFL-CIO voted in the later 1930s not to establish their own party but to merge with Democrats, that was the beginning of the end for the labor movement in this country. It's been backsliding ever since. It's very important to stand up and have that challenge.
What do you expect to accomplish on Election Day?
To gain back our political voice and our political courage, because the minute we do that, we have won. We don't have to win the White House, and if we do, and we can turn it into a greenhouse, and that would be a really cool thing, the world would be a better place for it, but we can win the day by standing up and reviving the voice of democracy. Without our voice in the political and electoral game, It's just a public relations battle between two Wall Street-sponsored parties who are competing for their corporate funding.
Last quick question. Is the media giving you, we're glad to have you here. As Doc said, we invited everybody. Maybe they'll show up in the next few days. But is the media giving you an opportunity to make your case?
A little bit more than ever before. And we're encouraging people to go to our website, jillstein.org, and join the movement because we deserve our Tahrir moment. And we have 8 weeks between now and then. Just think what they did in Tahrir Square without the media, without the money, without the big political parties. They totally booted out a military dictatorship that had been entrenched for 40 years. As Alice Walker says, the biggest way people give up power is by not knowing they have it to start with. We have it. People are waking up to it. Let's use it.
Please thank Dr. Jill Stein. Please thank Dr. Jill Stein, the Green Party candidate for President of the United States. We thank you for coming. All right, we're gonna close the show. We got a minute and a half to go. Quick questions or comments. I gotta keep the line moving. I just wanna hear from you right quick.
I'm Jerry Meyer. I'm a retired economic development official and resident of Cleveland for 44 years. I was gonna comment on the OEOC presentation. I think there are two things that with TARD growing the cooperative movement, and one is you need capital. And secondly, you need training of people who are going to be in those cooperatives, which the OEOC provides. The second thing I want to say and ask you two gentlemen is I think we've got to change the dialogue on this poverty discussion. Since the parties don't want to talk about poverty and poor, you got to change the language. We should be talking about entrepreneurship and growing small businesses. Those are chic right now. And you could help do it by pushing those as the ways to solve poverty.
We take your comment. Thank you very much. Yes.
My name is Pat Blahoviak. I'm from East Cleveland, and I'd like to bring the conversation back to education, which I feel is necessary but not sufficient for bringing people out of poverty. I think we need to look carefully at what's happening in Chicago, which is close to where I grew up in Milwaukee, and I see it as the result of the failed policies of Arne Duncan, and I'd like your help in bringing the conversation away from high-stakes testing, away from punishing teachers and schools, from charter schools that are destroying public education, and back to project-based learning and things that help.
We accept that. There's a whole chapter in our book about that very issue, and the rich and the rest of us. So we agree with you. Thank you.
Last question. Respect you. My name is Jeannie Joy from Greater Cleveland, Ohio, and I'm a proud person from the project 40 years ago. And I like to say, if teamwork make the dream work, now is a nightmare, and we definitely need to address that. And also, I wanted to know that tour 2.0, what does that mean? And I think you should have sections in your area for people of poverty and not just for
poverty. Thank you.
Good day. Bless you.
Thank you for tuning in from Cleveland. God bless you.
Cleveland, we implemented and founded a whole network called the HBCU Preparatory Schools Network, which takes those principles of the HBCU, the historically black colleges and universities, and implement them earlier, so that our children can get those experiences much earlier on.
We appreciate your work, and thank you for coming.
Appreciate it, though, brother.
Let me just take a moment right quick to ask you to thank the house band one more time.
Yeah, Brother Jeff, Moyes, and the others.
WCPN.
Sounding good.
WCPN, we thank you for having us. But most important to all of you who came and sat for 3 hours of a national broadcast, Dr. Weston, I appreciate you, we thank you, and we love you.
Thank you so very much.
And tell all your friends about the Poverty Tour 2.0. They can follow us online. Thank you, Cleveland. We love you for coming out. Thank you very much.
So much,
Jay-Z,
Cleveland, Ohio.
Our producer, we love you.
Jay-Z, Brother
thank you,
Joe.
Jay-Z.
One and only.
All right.